on our very own underground railroad.
The name, in honor of Harriet Tubman, who helped slaves escape via the Underground Railroad, was announced during a ceremony at the Expo Construction Yard. The moniker and artwork on the machine were chosen as part of a student contest.
I'm particularly proud that the award-winning TBM name of Harriet came from Calvin Mosley, a student at City Honors in the beautiful city of Englewood.
Mosley and artwork contest winner Brittany Hernandez beat out over 200 other competitors.
And I knew that the name was going to be coming out during Black History Month, so I chose Harriet, especially because it's going underground.
I'm really excited and happy about this, and I'm really happy that I'm in first place.
The tunnel boring machine will connect three underground light rail stations, Crenshaw Expo, Martin Luther King, and Leimert Park.
And I went down a few months ago to see what it's like and to be underneath Crenshaw Boulevard, one of our great streets that I've designated as the mayor of the city of Los Angeles, working with our council. It is amazing to be underneath this boulevard, to see its potential, to work with the business community, to make sure that nobody's put out of business during the business we're getting done.
The project is expected to take about 13 months. I'm Anita Bennett for LA This Week.
Contest winners Mosley and Hernandez will receive tap cards valued at $300, allowing them to ride Metro for free. Well, newly launched online maps will allow us to keep better tabs on road repairs and other projects affecting our neighborhoods. And as Gil Reyes reports, these real-time graphs might also speed up emergency response.
Let's say the big one hits. A major earthquake rocks Los Angeles, trapping students at area campuses. LAFD firefighters rushed to the scene, could make critical decisions faster using maps accessible on their smartphones. Hundreds of maps with real-time information on street closures, sewer lines, and the nearest fire hydrants.
Any information that would make it easier to respond to an emergency. And believe me, I've seen first responders go out there. And it's kind of like, hey, you go over there, try to figure that out. You go over there, look down at the sewer lines. And they're scrambling to do those things that we could maybe have in their palm the moment they arrive.
At a news conference broadcast live on YouTube from LaCrette's Innovation Campus, Mayor Eric Garcetti promotes LA's newly launched GeoHub, the latest in a string of open data tech innovations under his term. GeoHub is one of the largest online collections of urban maps, information in real time, aimed at improving emergency response and other city services such as pothole repairs, 311 calls, and urban planning. And these maps aren't just for city personnel. Journalists, students, anyone can use these apps to keep tabs on city trends.
So whether you're a university or a nonprofit or just an Angelino who's interested in what's going on in your community, there are hundreds of maps to choose from that allow you to analyze and get a better understanding of your neighborhood.
The city partnered with the company Esri, a leader in geographic technology, to launch the platform. The city's first four apps mainly monitor traffic and road construction, but could one day map homelessness, housing, and earthquake trends.
And suddenly, we've got geographic knowledge coming together through an open and accessible portal for everybody.
For improved city services and transparency, all mapped out in the palm of your hand. In downtown LA, Gil Reyes for LA This Week.
Real-time city data on an estimated 500 maps are available now. Download the apps at geohub.lacity.org. Well, LA officials try to make a golden impression for an upcoming bid to host the 2024 Olympics. Rasha Goel has more.
Thomas Bach, president of the International Olympic Committee, showed off his soccer skills at UCLA along with Los Angeles Mayor Eric Garcetti. Bach and other IOC officials visited the campus and other proposed venues for the 2024 Olympics.
We also were able to show some of the plans that we have for our bid, though, and the way that we're tying in a legacy and have continued to keep Olympics alive in Los Angeles.
Los Angeles represented the final stop in Bach's tour of four cities, including Paris, Rome, and Budapest, that are in the running to host the 2024 Summer Games.
It will be up to the different candidates now to make their point, to show their uniqueness.
LA is proposing to house athletes on the Westwood campus, saving $1 billion or more on construction of a separate Olympic Village. Bach didn't give any leads on which city might be the front runner, but he did say,
After this Olympic competition, there is only one medal. And there is no silver, there is no bronze. It's only the gold medal.
The lobbying will continue for another 20 months, with host candidates vying to impress IOC voters around the world. The International Olympic Committee will make the selection in 2017. I'm Rasha Goel for LA This Week.
Los Angeles was home to the Olympics in 1932 and 1984. While a new gun safety campaign hits the streets of LA, American Airlines expands services at LAX, and a historic library branch in Cypress Park is back in business. All these stories and more in City Beat.
Tenants and landlords of earthquake-vulnerable buildings will split seismic retrofitting costs under ordinance amendments approved by the LA City Council. The council approved amendments to a city law adopted last year, clarifying that tenants and landlords will share retrofitting costs equally. While tenants will be responsible for half of the costs, landlords will be required to cap the retrofitting costs for tenants at $38 per month. The retrofitting mandate targets brittle concrete buildings and soft-story structures with weak first floors that were built prior to when earthquake building codes were adopted in the late 1970s.
It's better, easier, smarter to go in at the front end and to do the retrofit than to come in after and try to rebuild.
Nearly 200 LA Department of Transportation Dash buses hit the streets outfitted with educational advertisements, urging Angelenos to lock it up and safely store their firearms when not in use. The ads read, "Lock it up, never let your gun get in the wrong hands." The ad depicts a young child holding a revolver. Councilmember Paul Krikorian, who spearheaded landmark gun storage legislation last year, says the campaign is meant to get people to stop and think.
And I'm sure that it's going to be shocking to some people to see this. I'm sure it's going to be disturbing, and it's meant to be.
It's important to get the word out because it's easy to forget to lock up, you know, your gun and not realize how it can get in the hands of young people and they can get hurt really easily.
American Airlines recently celebrated expansion plans at LAX. Airline officials gathered at the Hollywood Bowl to highlight new initiatives for 2016, including new services and routes, new partnerships, and new gates. American Airlines employs more than 5,000 workers in Southern California, which, according to officials, makes the airline one of the top 20 largest employers in Los Angeles. American operated 66,000 flights from more than 14 million passengers in 2015.
LA is a really important market for us, and we want to continue to grow our partnership with businesses and nonprofits in the community.
After being closed since 2008, the Richard Henry Dana Branch Library in Cypress Park has been reopened. Councilmember Gil Cedillo partnered with the city's Department of Recreation and Parks and Bureau of Engineering to reopen the branch. The 2,800-square-foot building, built in 1926, has been renovated but still maintains its historical significance. In 1987, the Dana Branch was added to the National Register of Historic Places, citing the building's charming one-story New England colonial revival-style architecture. In 2011, the City of LA named the building a historic and cultural monument. Improvements include new recreation space, new lighting, new roof, and other upgrades.
Each year, the City of LA hosts an award show for Oscar-nominated movies shot in California. Anita Bennett takes us to the 2016 Made in Hollywood Awards.
The paparazzi are in place and the red carpet is out for the fifth annual Made in Hollywood Awards.
This year, we're celebrating two animated feature films and one live-action feature film produced in California, right here in L.A.
Each year, the L.A. City Council recognizes Oscar-nominated films in the Best Picture and Best Animated Feature categories that were produced here in California. Paramount's stop-motion drama, Animalisa, and Disney's Inside Out made the cut.
This is disgust, and that's fear. We're Riley's emotions.
This year, Made in Hollywood introduced two new categories, including one honoring the season's most diverse Oscar contender. The biopic about gangster rap group N.W.A. was mostly overlooked by the Oscars, igniting a firestorm of controversy. But Councilman Mitch O'Farrell's office decided to honor Straight Outta Compton with a Diversity in Hollywood Leadership Award.
We need more diversity in the industry itself, across the board. And when we have that, I think that then we'll see that reflected in all the award nominations.
Meanwhile, Star Wars The Force Awakens composer John Williams received the inaugural Lifetime Contribution to Hollywood Award.
Nothing will stand in our way.
I wanted to do the music here with our orchestra here. But the people who really should be thanked for having this happen are starting off with J.J. Abrams, who was the director of the film, and Kathy Kennedy as producer.
Williams has previously taken home 5 Academy Awards. In Hollywood, I'm Anita Bennett for LA This Week.
The producer of Straight Outta Compton said they were able to shoot locally after qualifying for California's film tax credits. Well, LAX's International Terminal 2 now joins the Tom Bradley International Terminal as a world-class hub for global travelers. After months of renovation, it's finally open with new and exciting dining and retail options for passengers.
These are some glimpses of the latest upgrades at the new Terminal 2 at LAX. Los Angeles World Airports and Westfield recently unveiled the new terminal featuring 16 new dining and retail brands.
And this terminal alone, the second busiest international terminal at LAX, serves more than 1 million U.S. travelers and about 4 million travelers from abroad each year. To create a better travel experience for them, we're upgrading the ticket lobby, as well as the baggage screening and the baggage claim areas, and we improved all of the terminal's electrical, mechanical, and telecom systems.
The redevelopment project took 20 months to complete.
There's also a tremendous amount of work going on behind the scenes. And that work is critically important because that enables the technology, the cooling, the environment of this building to be sustainable and to serve the passengers.
This is the terminal's first renovation in nearly 30 years. And officials say they want passengers to experience the true taste of Los Angeles.
We at Westfield wanted to showcase the soul of Los Angeles. Our goal is to understand the needs of the passenger and to deliver a Southern California experience.
Ciabatta Bar, an Italian food destination with a focus on simple organic Italian food, is among the new eateries at the terminal.
And we're very proud of our product, of making everything from scratch. So we wanted to give the same experience to the customer that come to Hollywood as well to the travelers here at the Los Angeles Airport.
It's so fitting as we have reached a record-breaking number of passengers. We expect more growth in the near term. For LAX to have another terminal besides Tom Bradley International Terminal that really reflects the uniqueness, the culture, the vibrancy of the great city of Los Angeles.
A holistic customer journey that Los Angeles World Airports hopes to create for its passengers. In Los Angeles, I'm Rasha Goel for LA This Week.
Terminal 2 serves more than 5 million passengers annually. While bicycle infrastructure, safe streets, and family fun all came into play as Reseda got rolling on its annual West Valley Community Bike Ride. Anna Marcos brings us more.
The LAPD's black and whites flashed red and blue as the West Valley Community Ride kicked off, headed by Councilmember Bob Blumenfield. This is his third year taking in some fresh air with resident bicyclists of Reseda.
That's the goal here, is we're really trying to transform this area in a positive way.
I think this is fun. This is a good ride. It's a good way to bring out the community. It's a good way to promote cycling here in the valley.
The 10-mile route meandered through streets, the Orange Line Bikeway and the L.A. River Bikeway, and LAPD cops came along for the ride.
If you see some of our officers that are bike uniform, get used to them. We're going to introduce the bike detail out here to Reseda, so it'll be great.
But Councilmember Blumenfield isn't just concerned with transforming Reseda residents and cops into bike riders. He wants to transform the area itself. After the bike ride, he held a workshop to talk about the Reseda corridor's future. Among the plans, building an ice rink for residents with Prop K money.
I
love going on the bike rides, especially on weekends, since it's not having to be somewhere at a certain time. It's not commuting. And also, I want to hear what changes that they're going to do.
After the bike ride, we're going to have vision boards. We're going to have discussion. We're going to basically be getting a lot of community input on what people want to see in this area.
In honor of the occasion, the Los Angeles Kings set up a hockey rink and puck shoot. Family fun, safe streets, and healthy ways to ride and play. It looks like this bike ride was a resounding success. I'm Anna Marcos for LA This Week.
The bike ride is part of the Reseda Rising Initiative and LA's Great Streets Initiative. While a new group of LAPD recruits joins the force to protect and serve, Rasha Goel has more.
25 graduates recently celebrated their success in becoming the LAPD's newest officers. The graduation ceremony was held at the Los Angeles Police Academy.
You have to remember what it was inside of you that made you want to be a Los Angeles police officer. And then always be true to that. Always.
LAPD Chief Charlie Beck also reminded the recruits of their collective goals.
I want you to make this city safer, and I want you to build public trust.
Graduates were also honored for excellence in several categories, including most inspirational, weapon proficiency, and human relations.
The number one officer and recipient of the William H. Parker Award for Class 815 is Officer Daniel Battles.
We cannot wait to get out there and start doing the job that we've pursued for so long. I know it won't be easy, but with the determination that I've seen demonstrated in the academy, I know we can achieve it.
The recruits completed 920 hours of training over 24 weeks.
You are now members of a very big and very special family. You will be the people keeping a watchful eye on our communities and keeping our families and neighborhoods safe from harm. You will be the people that our city turns to in the face of a natural disaster.
They are faces of new hopes and dreams that will now spread their wings in the City of Angels. I'm Rasha Goel for LA This Week.
Of the 25 graduates, 21 were males and 4 were females. An annual event is bringing kids from all over LA together to compete in a friendly game of ball while honoring a civil rights leader.
He steals, he dribbles, he shoots, and he scores. As these kids take part in the 7th annual Dream Games, named in honor of Martin Luther King Jr.
Dr. Martin Luther King, his famous speech, I Have a Dream.
Wearing Dr. King t-shirts, kids between the ages of 7 and 12 tipped off the games at the Westwood Recreational Center with some high-energy action on the court.
I'm just here to represent Pan Pacific in the Dream Games. Pretty excited.
The Dream Games were created to recognize Dr. King and to bring folks together for one common goal, to give kids in L.A. the chance to play sports.
Seeing kids from different parks that seem to be isolated and segregated from one another, we thought it would be a good idea to bring those kids together and make sure that they had a clear understanding of what the ethnicities were and had respect for one another.
The Dream Games are made possible through a partnership between the Department of Rec and Parks and Friends of West LA. The games provide children from 11 different Los Angeles City recreation centers the opportunity to participate in a basketball exhibition.
This is a great example of an opportunity to recognize Martin Luther King's legacy and bring together the diversity that is Los Angeles.
Some of the 11 participating recreation centers include Chevy Chase, Costello, Cypress, Echo, Expo, Highland, and Westwood.
To get the game schedule or to learn how to participate, call the Westwood Recreation Center at 310-473-3610. Well, here's your chance to see the Harlem Globetrotters in action, celebrate the Year of the Monkey with a fireworks display, and shop for some unique merchandise in downtown LA. That's all in this week's Things to Do.
They're making their way to Los Angeles during their 90th anniversary world tour. The world-famous Harlem Globetrotters will be playing 2 games at the Los Angeles Staples Center on February 21st. Don't miss your chance in seeing the iconic team in action. For 90 years, the Harlem Globetrotters have provided smiles, encouraged sportsmanship, and service to millions of people worldwide. A mix of athleticism, entertainment, trick shots, and ball handling will keep the family smiling and entertained. The star-studded roster features Big Easy Lofton, plus female star TNT Maddox, and more. For more information, visit HarlemGlobetrotters.com. Under a pale blue sky. It's the year of the monkey. The LA Chinatown Firecracker Run annual event brings family and friends to participate in the festivities. The run includes a bike ride on February 20th, a 5K run, a 10K run, and a kiddie run on February 21st. The event will also include a lighting of the fireworks ceremony and admission to the Firecracker Festival, carnival games, and petting zoo for kiddie run participants. The event will also include a lighting of the fireworks ceremony, a firecracker festival, carnival games, and petting zoo for kiddie run participants. All proceeds and donations go to local elementary schools and nonprofit community organizations providing service and programs to benefit the community. The LA Chinatown Firecracker Run Committee has contributed more than $500,000 so far. For more information, visit firecracker10k.org. Do some shopping at the Artists and Fleas during the weekend of February 20th and 21st. Located nearby downtown Los Angeles Art District, this flea market is a community event that showcases art, design, and fashion, alongside a selection of vintage and upcycled merchandise. This market also presents LA's notable food trucks, makers workshops, and special events for the entire family. From New York, Artists and Fleas branched out to LA in 2014. The market is open every third weekend from 11 to 5 p.m. For more, visit artistsandfleas.com. And that's a look at some things to do. Well, that's going to do it for this edition. I'm Yana Kane from all of us here at LA This Week. Thanks for joining us. A reminder, you can catch us online at lacityview.org. You can also follow and like us on Facebook. We'll see you back here next week for more of LA This Week.
Started that one day. I knew then my destiny. To have a career where I can achieve my best. Where every day is different. Where lifelong friendships are made. Where I'm saving lives and inspiring others. My name is Mackenzie Vandergeest, and I am a Los Angeles firefighter.
Don't worry, Patty. This isn't going to hurt me one bit. Hi, I'm Dr. Eric Shapiro in beautiful Encino, and you're watching LA City View, Channel 35. Our city, our channel. Open wide.
sergeants, please call the members, have them report to the council chambers. I want to thank Mr. Bonin Buscaino. Mr. Blumenfield is here. Members, if you're in your offices, report to the council chambers so that we can begin our work for today. Okay, today is Wednesday. Can I have your attention? Today is Wednesday, February 17th. Welcome to your Los Angeles City Council. This council meets every... This council meets every Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday at 10 a.m. The public is welcome. Mr. Clerk, we have a quorum. Could you please call the roll?
Blumenfield, Bonin, Buscaino, Cedillo, Engler, Fuentes, Harris, Dawson, Weezer, Carrasco, Corian, Martinez, O'Farrell, Price, Rue, Wesson, 11 members present, and a quorum, Mr. President.
Okay, first order of business.
Approval of the minutes.
Rue moves, Martinez seconds, next.
Commendatory resolutions for approval.
Cedillo moves, O'Farrell seconds, next.
Mr. President, the Office of Finance recommends that items 2 A, B, C, and E be received and filed in as much as the taxpayers have made payment arrangements for the liabilities owed. The Department of Building and Safety recommends that items 1C, D, E, G, P, Q, R, and 43, C, F, and H be received and filed in as much as the liens were paid in full. That items 1N and 1V be received and filed in as much as the properties were determined to be owner-occupied single-family dwellings. That item 43A be received and filed. That item 43D be reduced to $398.56 due to late fees being rescinded by the department. And that item 43W be received and filed in as much as the lien was rescinded by the department. Further, there are requests to continue items 1S and 43PTNT to March 2nd.
Okay, so without objection, that'll be the order that brings Mr. Bonin.
I'd like to continue item 1X for 30 days.
So, Mr. Bonin, item 1X to March 18th, Mr. Clerk.
Very good, sir.
Okay, let's move on.
Mr. President?
Yes, sorry. Mr. Englander.
Thank you. And 43K for 30 days, please.
So we'll do that, and that'll be March 18th as well. Mr. Sadia.
Yes, sir. On 1Y, we moved to remove the surcharges and late fees, sir.
And again, Mr. Sadio, give me that.
We want to remove the surcharge and late fees on 1Y, sir.
Without objection.
Thank you.
Okay, where are we, Mr. Clerk?
Mr. President, items 1 through 18 are items noticed for public hearing.
Do we have cards?
Yes, sir. Cards on items 1, 2, 8, and 18.
Let's hold those items and let's vote on the remaining items. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
Twelve ayes.
Thank you. Continue.
Mr. President, that brings us to items 19 through 40. They're items for which public hearings have been held. There are requests to send items 22 and 23 forthwith, and a motion is required for item 32. It should be held on the desk.
Okay, we'll hold 32, and let us, members, any specials? We'll vote on the... Mr. Previn, please, you're disrupting the meeting. Okay, let us, on the remaining items, let's open the... Mr. Krikorian.
Item 31, please.
31 for Mr. Krikorian. Let us open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Okay, let's continue. Mr. Rue.
Please.
23 forthwith, and... was it 22 as well?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let's move on.
Mr. President, items 41 and 42 are items scheduled for closed session. Would you like to hold them on the desk?
I will defer. Why don't we hold them right now and we'll move on. So let's hold those items and move on, Mr. Clerk, to the next agenda items.
Very good. On the continuation agenda, items 43 and 44 are items noticed for public hearing.
Do we have cards?
On item 44, sir.
Okay, let's hold item 4. No one wishes to speak on 43. Let's prepare to vote on that item. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
That brings us where?
Items 45 through 80 are items for which public hearings have been held.
Okay, specials, members. Mr. Englander.
Thank you, Mr. President. 73 and 74, we're circulating an amendment.
Okay, let's hold those. Let's vote on the remaining. Let's, Mr. Krikorian.
51, please.
51.
Thank you.
Let's vote on the remaining. Let us open the roll. No, we'll scratch that, Ms. Martinez.
Sorry about that, Mr. President. No 49 problem. For Mr. Weezer. We can continue it until February 23rd.
Okay, so
item 49 for Mr. Weezer.
On item 49, there's a request that that item be continued until February 23rd. Let's hold item 45. Let's vote on the remaining. Let's open the roll. Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Continue.
Items 81.
Wait, Mr. Root.
Mr. President, 59 forthwith.
Without objection, 59 forthwith. Yes.
Items 81 through 94 are items for which public hearings have not been held. 10 votes are required for consideration.
Mr. Fuentes.
Number 87, special for a technical amendment.
In fact, before we do that, let me just say without objection, those items are now before this body. And what number was that, Mr. Fuentes?
87.
87. Mr. Krikorian.
Item number 90, please, Mr. President.
90 from Mr. Krikorian. Mr. Englander.
Thank you very much. 82, special, please, and then 89 for a friendly amendment that's being be circulated.
Okay. Cards again. 94 for Mr. Root. Mr. Blumenfield.
Number 83 special, please.
83 special. Anything left, Mr. Clerk?
I believe that leaves for items, the items that don't have cards and that haven't been called special for, by a member, that leaves 84, 85, 88, and 93.
Okay, does that sound about right? Well, let's vote on those items. Let's open the roll, close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Okay, that brings us where?
Mr. President, that takes council back to items called special or public comment for
okay,
items.
Okay, I'm going to go to Mr. Krikorian.
Thank you, Mr. President. If we can go back to items 41 and 42.
Yes, sir.
Both of those are settlements that have been considered by Budget and Finance, which recommends approval of the city attorney's recommendations. Those can be resolved in open session unless members have questions or concerns.
Okay. Well, why don't we try to handle those now, Mr. Clerk, if you could read those
very
two
good,
items.
Sir. For item 41, in the case entitled Naranjabai Patel et al. Versus City of Los Angeles, there is a recommendation to expend $668,370.80 in settlement of attorneys' fees and costs incurred on appeal. And for item 42, in the case entitled Travon Johnson versus City of Los Angeles et al., there is a recommendation to expend $550,000 in settlement.
Okay, members, let's prepare to vote on those items. Let's open the roll. Let's close the roll and tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
That brings us where, Mr. Clerk?
Items called special.
Okay, Mr. Englander.
So is it newly added, right?
Newly added, yeah.
Okay.
She just called him. Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm going to call him Mr. Englander.
Great. Thank you very much, colleagues and council member. Council members, Council President Wesson, I'd like to first and foremost, apologize for any inconvenience yesterday. The Public Safety Committee meeting, which was scheduled at 8:30, did begin, in fact, on time. But we had a one-item agenda and went much longer than it should have, and in fact, for over a couple hours. But notwithstanding that, the most important thing, and I stand behind the Council President on this 100%, so we absolutely have to meet in Council on time to do the people's work. And so it becomes a very big inconvenience for many, including staff and others, when that doesn't occur. So I'll make sure that, as the chair of that committee, that won't happen in public safety again. And if there is an issue, quite frankly, and I take full responsibility for that, if there's an issue that requires much more time and we can't finish or adjourn that meeting, we'll recess the meeting and continue it either that afternoon or some other time in the future. I also want to thank, though, my colleagues that were at the committee meeting. It was a robust and critical discussion that will continue as well, but wanted to start the council meeting with that this morning and thank the council president personally for your leadership.
Thank you. Stuff happens. Now let's get back to work. Why don't we take up item 45? Why don't we ask Ms. Bartels to come forward? Somebody that we all know. We want to, many of us around this horseshoe have known you for many years, and now we have an opportunity to confirm you for a leadership position, one that you've worked very hard and you're deserving of. And so I thought it would make sense to have you say a few words. And I, again, like I said yesterday, I'm sorry your parents aren't here today, but you are here today. So why don't you let us know the direction or the future that you're going to take this office in? Ms. Bartels, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I am honored to be with all of you here today and excited to begin this new chapter of public service. I'd like to thank Mayor Garcetti for placing his trust and confidence in me in presenting me with this opportunity to become the next Director of Finance for the City of Los Angeles. I am committed to enabling the Office of Finance to be the most responsive, the most efficient, and the most effective office that it can possibly be. And I look forward to collaborating with each of you and the City Council, the Mayor, and our greater business community to ensure that that happens. As you've mentioned, and as I know a number of you know, I have devoted my entire career to public service. And I'd like to say that public service to me is not just a job, it's not just a title, it's not just a position. For me, public service is my passion. And that passion stems from the people that I've worked with, and the people that I've served. The residents of the City of Los Angeles, the business community, the hardworking men and women employed here at the City of Los Angeles, and including the special team, the amazing team in the City Controller's Office that I've had the pleasure of working with these last 6.5 years. And of course, the incredible people that I have worked with, worked for, including, but not limited to, former Councilwoman Cindy Misikowski in the 11th District, former City Councilwoman and former City Controller Wendy Gruhl, and a man that I have worked for and at his side for the last 2.5 years, whom I greatly respect and admire, and who has taught me a great deal, Los Angeles City Controller Ron Galperin. Lastly, but certainly not least, and I know this sounds a bit more like an acceptance speech, but thank you for indulging me, are the people who have supported me in my passion these many years, and that's the people closest to me, my family. Thank you for acknowledging my parents, who are the greatest role models a daughter could ever wish to have, Bob and Bobby Thompson. My husband, my rock, former general manager, John Kirk Muckery, and my children, my two children, who would be here today, except for the fact that they're pursuing their own passions. My daughter in theater, and my son who's serving our country in the United States Air Force. I love this city, and I am so proud to be accepting this opportunity that we are here for today. Thank you very, very much. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much. I think that you're just so well known around this horseshoe and so highly respected. There are no questions at this point in time. We are excited about you, excited about the future, and we all feel sorry about Mr. Galperin. But life goes on. So with that said, why don't we open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 out.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, let's go to item two quickly. Mr. Previn on item two. Yes, sir.
Good morning, Council President Wesson. It is Eric Previn on item two. Which meeting is this?
Mr. Previn, just speak to item two.
Just clarify.
No, no. Mr. Previn, speak to the item. If you don't know what meeting it is, then how could you fill a card out?
I'm on item 2E, which is...
Just speak to the item.
Well, I'd like to know... Okay, fine, sir. It's 2E.
One more time, and then you'll forfeit your time.
It's a lien that we're settling with a group called MGA, Inc. MGA is a entertainment company that work out of CD6. That's Nuri Martinez's district. And they're also in business with Mr. Englander at 20,000 Prairie. They're doing a big 660-unit development. And here they're being fined $31,000 for not paying their taxes. So it raised a little bit of curiosity among the public as to how in the world that could be happening, that we're chasing around a guy who we, in my view, gave an extraordinarily good deal, because whereas Jameson is providing 10% and low affordable, this group is providing zero affordable. They're providing $200,000 here and $200,000 there to 501c3s of Mr. Englander's liking, but that's it. And frankly, in this era when development is needed, but not any development, this is a special development for employees of his company in a set of high-rises out at the old Times plant. So the idea that he's in debt to the city caught me off guard. It's Mr. Isaac Larian, for those who have forgotten. I'm sure none of you have forgotten. This is a real bad feeling for the public, I must tell you, because I know what's going to happen. This will be either settled or he'll pay the little petty thing. But ordinary residents are chased by you guys. I mean, you've got 50 of them on the agenda today. Sir, clean up your act.
Let's prepare to vote on this item. Let's open the roll. Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Let's move to item 8. I believe it's a Samuel Sakutan. Samuel, please come forward. Yes, sir.
Sorry, this is on item 89?
On item 8 is what I have on your card.
Excuse me, item 89, I apologize.
Okay, well, why don't you, I'll call you again when we get to 89.
Thank you,
okay?
Mr. President.
On 8, we'll open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Item 92, Mr. Walsh. John Walsh on item 92.
John Walsh, blogging at HollywoodHighlands.org or J. Walsh Confidential. Tweeting at Hollywood Dems. This is a council district 2, Mr. Kerkorian. We want to make his district more beautiful. Of course, currently, even he admits it needs enormous amounts of graffiti removal. Right now, Mr. Kerkorian is asking for $30,000 worth of graffiti removal. I mean, I just want everyone to know, you want a graffiti, anybody who wants to do graffiti, go to Mr. Kerkorian's area, because especially if you're white, because they're not going to arrest you if you're black, unless you're black. $30,000, Council District 2, for worthless graffiti, racist graffiti removal, HollywoodHighlands.org.
Okay, let us vote on this item. Let's open the roll. Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Okay, now we'll move to item 83, which is called special by Dan. Item 83.
One minute only, please. One minute only. So, energy efficiency. Can anyone here tell me where city council is efficient at anything? You weren't efficient at the NFL, and you lost, and you cost us money. You weren't efficient.
Stay on the subject.
I am. I'm giving examples of how you guys don't know shit about efficiency.
Stay on the subject.
City attorney, I'm talking about efficiency. Can I get a ruling, please?
No, just stay on the subject.
Okay, well, tell us, how are you going to lower the bills? How are you going to lower the energy bills, right? You screwed up $41 million of our money, and now you're going to tell us now you're going to be efficient about it? That's because Mr. Wesson's name on this. And even though I only want 1 minute on this, Herb, you're charging me for two. Please, 1 minute only. And you can follow me on Twitter.
You're off the subject. Thank you very much, Mr. Bloomingfield. Mr. Bloomingfield.
Great. No, this was one that we had called special, and I wanted to really raise this issue, and I wanted to start by thanking Councilmember Fuentes, who is the chair of the Energy and Environment Committee, for allowing this important initiative to come directly to the council in advance of the rates discussion that we're going to have later this afternoon. It was important to me to create something tangible for our constituents who need relief from the extreme heat of the summer and with this crazy weather, extreme heat sometimes of the winter in the San Fernando Valley. Our most vulnerable populations need relief for their well-being. When you talk about energy use and you talk about air conditioning, for folks who live in the hot areas of this city, it is not a luxury. Air conditioning is a necessity. It can even be a life or death situation. For folks who don't realize the temperature differential, in parts of the city, it can be 20 degrees hotter in the West San Fernando Valley than on the west side of the city. So that's why I asked the DWP to help ratepayers realize substantial savings on their bill by having air conditioning systems and other appliances reviewed for performance, including maintenance efficiency checks at no rate to the individual ratepayer. After months of working with them, they answered the call to help constituents of the West Valley and not just raise rates on their backs. But in the end, we actually developed a program that will help the entire city. The largest source of energy use for most of my constituents is the heating and cooling system. Indeed, for all constituents in the city, it's the heating and cooling system for your home or building. It also happens to be one of the most neglected saving components. Many homes have leaky air distribution systems or duct systems. Each of these problems represents significant energy waste and causes rate charges to go up, particularly in the summer months when the cooling systems in many areas like the San Fernando Valley continuously operate to keep basic relief from the heat. To provide this relief, I have asked and received a well-developed DWP program that maximizes energy efficiencies and can actually lower people's bills. This includes free-of-charge air filter replacements, outdoor coil and flow adjustments, including refrigerant charge assessments, all things for people who need to live healthy lives in the heat and not worry about whether or not they can afford to keep a basic temperature in their house. All of these energy efficiency components have a potential for reducing cooling and heating costs, and get this, up to 30%. It is a very significant possibility if you get your systems up and running. It's like having the air in your tires when you're driving on the highway. Having the right air pressure in your tires can make a huge difference on fuel efficiency. These are significant savings, particularly for ratepayers that reside in the hottest areas of the city, like the San Fernando Valley. So the DWP has promised to reach out to needy ratepayers on this program, conduct workshops to utilize this new program throughout the city. This will also create jobs. The jobs we create in energy efficiency will grow throughout the city as DWP sends out approved vendors to homes throughout the area to ratepayers for free. Let's save ratepayer dollars on the eve of the robust discussions we're going to have about DWP rates. This is something tangible we can do. The city of Los Angeles must help our ratepayers lower their bills in any way possible. This motion does that, and I'd like to ask DWP CFO Jeff Peltola and Director of Rates Neil Gugliano to answer a few questions at the table. So with that as a starting point, let me start by asking, is it true that ratepayers' bills could actually be lower if they take advantage of this program, even if the rate increases proposed by DWP are put into effect?
Thank you, Council Member. Yes, it is true because part of this, when it will, as you pointed out, 20 to 30% savings that we'll get on the air conditioning costs. And that's going to be the highest tier energy. So it will, it should mitigate their entire rate increase. Their bill should go down as we go forward because it's such a high savings on the energy. And it's a win-win for everything. It's also a win for the environment as well. And it's the lowest cost to serve our customers.
And you mentioned that you're going to do outreach efforts throughout the area. What's the plan for outreaching so that folks know about this program?
Yes, Councilman. So our plan for outreach is to utilize a third-party administrator to help us get the word out. We also will be doing direct email to customers. We'll partner with local community-based organizations to help get the word out. Using our customer service centers, we have open house Saturday events. We'll use that as a vehicle to get the word out. We use neighborhood councils, social media, and our other city departments, such as the housing department, to help get the word out to all of our customers.
Now, some people think, well, it's too good to be true if you can lower your bill. How are we going to pay for our infrastructure if we're lowering bills in this regard? Can you explain what how that would work?
Sure.
Would we be losing any money for infrastructure?
We will not lose any money. We accounted for a 15% energy efficiency goal in our financial plans. This is going to be a big part of that. And so all of the rates assume that we're going to have these types of reductions. This, obviously, I think will be very cost-effective and will serve our residential customers in a very cost-effective way.
And I see my time here, but just if you could explain in layman's terms how the initiative would work from start to finish of how a ratepayer would get into this free program and when they would start seeing savings on their bill.
Absolutely. So our ratepayers will be able to contact us at the Department of Water and Power directly or our third-party administrator. They'll be scheduled for and receive a complimentary AC diagnostic and maintenance service program. As you mentioned, that'll include things such as filter replacements, clean of outdoor coils, refrigerant checks, and other things. And as those things are done, the system will operate more efficiently. They'll start to immediately see that impact in terms of their bills going down based on more efficient operation of their AC systems.
Now, while this is a very significant new program to be put forward, I know what other programs are out there that will complement this program in terms of incentives for people to lower their bill?
So we have a variety of energy efficiency and water conservation programs, probably the most effective, especially out in the valley. The real consumers, as you mentioned, is the air conditioning and heating costs, which this program will address. Next thing is pool pumps. Most people don't think that the pool pumps consume as much energy as they do. They consume a great deal of energy. We have a $1,000 rebate for variable speed pool pumps, which will pay off in about a year and a half for our customers. It's, again, a win-win. We have a variety of different things to replace refrigerators, water conservation, all of that, again, available on our website.
Great. Thank you. Appreciate that. Close by saying, you know, members, a kilowatt of energy saved is worth a kilowatt earned or generated. This is a way that we can create energy savings. We can provide a benefit to our ratepayers. And so I strongly urge an aye vote on this new incentive program. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Blumenfield. With that, members, let's open the roll, close the roll, and tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Okay, that's approved. Let's move to item 44, called special by Mr. Hunt and Mr. Walsh. Item 44.
John Walsh, blogging at HollywoodHighlands.org, tweeting at Hollywood Dems. We're now up to that. This concerns the Little Tokyo Business Improvement District and an enormous amount of a special assessment on the BID. Now, the merchants and property owners pay for this. In other words, they're treated as incredibly racist-wise, the Little Tokyo people. It's filthy there. They don't clean the streets when they're supposed to. They allow crime to occur right open on the street. But they have the nerve. This BID is a tax on all the property owners and the businesses. HollywoodHighlands.org.
Thank you, Mr. Hunt.
The Red Chief Hunt on the record for Little Tokyo. I think that if it's an investment for Little Tokyo, then it should be made. If the property tax and the owners are paying for it, then it should be accepted. But let's clean up Little Tokyo night and day so that the property improvements will be adjusted so that they can make more money. I am the Red Chief Hunt.
Thank you. No hollering, Mr. We don't want to break our equipment. Let's prepare to vote. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
We're going to now move to item 51. Mr. Kerkorian, item 51. I do have a card. I'd like to call up on item 51, Reverend Charles Harrell. Reverend Charles Harrell. I see you. Please come forward, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Morning.
My name is Charles Harrell. I am also a city employee. I want to thank you for the honor to speak today before all of you on item 51, parental leave. Parental leave, as my understanding, offers 4 months paid leave to city employees. This affords fathers, mothers, the ability to greatly solidify their family structure. As a father, my motivation is to provide influence, stability, protection, hope, and a legacy of integrity for my children to walk in. As a minister and a community leader, also a chaplain, my motives are the same for my neighbors. Simply put, this item greatly advances those efforts and helps families, new and seasoned, the ability, gives them great ability to solidify their family foundation. And it would help greatly and would be very appreciative if you voted in favor.
Thank you for coming down, sir. Mr. Kerkorian, that ends the public comment on that item.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Members, in virtually the entire developed world, government mandates that employers provide paid parental leave of some sort when a family is expanding. And the United States as a whole has fallen woefully behind the rest of the world in that regard. But that's starting to change. Even now, the United States military is expanding paid parental leave. There are cities throughout our country that are expanding parental leave, and importantly, so is the private sector. So as we're entering into a mode where we're beginning to expand the city's workforce, as we recover from the Great Recession, as so much of our workforce is retiring and needing to be replaced now, we need to be competitive for the best, for the brightest people who will want to come to work for the city. And in order to do that, in order to be competitive with the rest of the private sector, we need to make sure that we provide this sort of benefit to allow young families to be able to come to work and still know that they won't be neglecting their obligations to their children. So this is the first step in what will be a long process of analysis, of consideration of the economics of this, considering the detriment that the city faces when we lose good employees because they don't have the option to take paid leave when they have a family. And we heard testimony from so many employees in committee who have used up all of their sick time, used up all of their vacation time when they have a child, and then when that child becomes sick a few months later, or when a family member becomes sick, or when they want to have another child in the next year or two, they haven't accrued sufficient time to be able to take additional time off to take care of those needs. So this is just a common sense measure that will help us attract and retain the best possible talent. It'll help us to be a supportive employer of our employees when they need our support the most. And it will help lay the foundation for the future citizens of Los Angeles, the children of our employees, to get off to the right kind of start
by being able to bond with their families at the time when they're most vulnerable. So I want to thank Councilmember Martinez for partnering in this effort with us, and I hope that this will be the first step in a successful journey in helping Los Angeles lead our country and make a strong statement that paid parental leave should be a fundamental requirement of employment of any employer anywhere in this country. I hope Los Angeles will lead the way.
Well, why don't we hear from Ms. Martinez?
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. Kerkorian, I want to thank you for bringing this forward and asking me to partner with you. I just want to mention that 7 years ago today at 12:15 in the afternoon, I became a mom for the first time. So it's my daughter's birthday today. So I think it's even more symbolic that we get to vote on this. Happy birthday, Izzy.
Happy birthday.
And I can tell you from personal experience what it was to give birth and basically be a mess for the first couple of months after having my baby. And had I not banked my sick leave and my vacation time, it would have been very difficult for me to have stayed home for almost 4 months. Coupled with the fact that my husband also was given the opportunity to stay with me for the first month of our baby's life. So that, Mr. Kerkorian, goes a long way, not only trying to figure out what you're doing as new parents, but also as a way to give an opportunity for those who are starting families that want to go and have a baby, for women who want to return to the workforce. As our employees are aging and retiring, the opportunity for those who wait a little longer to start a family and are able to take the necessary time to bond with their children and then come back to work and feel like it was enough, not feel that guilt that you carry with you almost every day because you wish you can be with your kids. But you have to work and you have to make ends meet. So this gives an opportunity for the city to send a message that if you're going to go off and have a family, we want to adopt a paid parental leave so you have an opportunity to bond with your children and still have a job to come to. So, colleagues, I ask for your support in moving this forward. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Ms. Martinez. Mr. Bonin.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just wanted to rise to thank Mr. Kerkorian for this piece of legislation. One of the things, I can't top anything Ms. Martinez said, obviously, but one of the things I do want to comment on is that this is inclusive of not just birth parents, but adoptive and foster parents. And it is so vitally important for new parents of a child that has come to their family through adoption or foster care to have that time to bond with the child that I think this is essential. And I thank you for your leadership.
Thank you. Let's prepare to vote on this item. Let's open the roll. Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Okay, let's move on to item 81. Mr. Walsh, John Walsh, item 81.
John Walsh, blogging at HollywoodHighlands.org and at J. Walsh Confidential. 81 again is REAP, where you do a good job for we the renters. And I'd like to point out that this is two meetings, so you owe us 10 minutes. Two meetings this.
Okay, let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Okay, now we'll move to item 91, called by Mr. Gus, item 91.
One minute only, please. Item 91, 1 minute only. So this says the shooting of Mitchell Maya. And that's kind of an understatement, Mr. Wesson. He wasn't shot, he was killed. Now, I guess the question is, why do all your other rewards say murdered, the murder of this person or that person, but this person who was murdered, it only says he was shot? So what is the difference? What is unique about this? Why is it inconsistent with every other murder award that you have? The young man wasn't shot. He was murdered. He is dead. Shooting implies that he's still alive. By the way, please make sure I'm only charged for a minute for this. Again, to the public, this happened in Boyle Heights. The $50,000, if you do get it, it's taxable. You do not get $50,000. It can be shared. It's dangerous. It doesn't work. And it's not enough money to get you out of Dodge. Something's wrong here. Thank you.
Thank you. Let us prepare to vote on that item. Let's open the roll. Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Item 1 will go to, if I could get Ms. McAllister, Ms. Fogler, and Mr. Walsh. Please, Mr. Walsh, I thought I heard him say pass, so let's go McAllister, Fogler, and Ms. Pearman.
Thank you, Mr. President. I see that the list is still long, a list of people who are threatened to have their houses foreclosed on. They have these liens on their homes. And I see that you're doing some work in actually talking to these people and getting the rates down or the amounts of money they have to pay. So I like that. So I like to give credit where credit is due, but it's not enough. I think in a year you're taking about maybe a couple of thousand homes. Where are you giving them to, or who are you giving them to? Developers and yourselves and your relatives. You got homes for three generations down. We won't even have a country by that time when you get through screwing things up. I like to say that I sympathize with our elected officials here because a lot of you don't have control on what really happens. You're voting and doing what the powers that be tell you to do, and I'll talk about that later. We need to get these people in the city chamber here because one man came in and Councilmember Price talked to him, probably got those taxes taken off of his account. So we need the people to come in here. If you find yourself on this list, get in here and talk to your council person. You elect these people for a reason. You elect them to help you out. Remember now, we're talking about gangsters. These are gangsters we're dealing with. I'm not saying the council members are gangsters, but they represent the gangsters. So we got to deal with them like we're gangsters. You see what I mean? These are not church-going Christians, Catholics, Jews. I don't know what they are, but we're dealing with gangsters. Now remember, the power is higher than this. These are not the gangsters. They represent the gangsters. So as far as I'm concerned, they're going to fall with the gangsters. You see, if you're going to do this kind of work, rip the people off, take advantage of the citizens, then you need to get yours too. And then we'll have people afraid to front for the gangsters. We need to put some fear in your hearts. Thank you.
Yes, Miriam, come forward.
Is this what number one? Number one. Okay, your building and safety is really behind, and they're not up to par on things. They take very slow time. I'm kind of disappointed in the service here in the city. And the people who have these liens should come out here, and maybe then they can have it dismissed. So, I'm just pretty disappointed. I came all the way down here, and now I don't get to speak on the DWP thing. Thank you. I'm 1 minute.
Yes, Ms. Pearman.
Yeah, and again, you have tons of liens all the way down up to Z, though I'm sure by now you're probably going to put some of them off, like that's all you do. And it shows I don't know why there's so many liens. I mean, it can't be a good job, like he says, if all these people owe money. And I'm tired of having these people. There's got to be a way to work these things out so these people don't owe so much money. And, today's a big waste of time. Someone told me there was a great big thing for the DWP, and now all I can do is tell you off for having liens. So let's work with these people and get them paid off, and don't overdo it with late fees. No late fees.
Okay, let's prepare to vote. Let's open the roll, close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
13 ayes. 13 ayes.
Let's go to, I believe, item 87, Mr. Fuentes.
President, colleagues, I raise this issue just for a technical amendment. I'd like to, the motion that was referenced in item 87 says to take an existing chief urban forester position and reclassify it. It should read existing chief management analyst and reclassify that. That's the only change that we've got. Ask for an aye vote.
Okay, with that said, let's prepare to vote. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
You know what I want to do on item one, Mr. City Attorney, I want a quick vote on reconsideration. Mr. Hunt, please come forward. On item one. And Ruth Cernoff. Please come forward, Ruth and Mr. Hunt. Item one. Let's vote on reconsideration. Let's open the roll. Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
13 ayes.
Okay, Ms. Cernoff.
I can only tell you what I experienced on the internet last night. And to me, it raises a lot of red flags. The biggest red flag is the number of liens that are exactly the same amount of money down to the penny and have the same scribbled transference of funds from one trusteeship to another. There's some graft going in there. There's no... The signatures are all bad. I ran one of those. There are, I counted 8 or 9 last night. I'm only counting 5 or 6 of them this morning, but they're all for a lien of $1,288.56. There's one in Council D for that, Council District 3. There's another one. I may be missing them. I'm looking really fast. There's also another one in 3. There's another one in Council District 10. There's another in Council District 15. And there's another in Council District 1. And they're all for the same exact amount of money, $1,288.56. And if the title and the way that the transference and this is taking place is the same in all of these procedures, then we're really in trouble because there's some things that just aren't right. And because I need to further research this, I will simply give you a copy of one of the 128856 one so that you know what you're looking for in case you want to pursue it.
Thank you. Mr. Hunt?
Vote yes on the reconsideration. I am the Red Chief Hunt.
Let's prepare to vote. Let's open the roll. Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Okay, we're going to go to item 82. I have cards, Ms. Fogler, Ms. Pierman, and Mr. Previn on item 82. Miriam, come forward. Item 82. Ms. Fogler, item 82.
Yeah, I don't know what you're doing, but you're playing hopscotch with these people's lives. And what we're concerned about now, the whole San Fernando Valley is being compromised, the air down there, because, you know, we're in a valley. And the air sits more. So this is like air pollution. You know what you've done is bringing that gas leak in there. So my neighbor across the street said, well, I guess we're going to have it here also here in Panorama City. Coming down here, you know, all the way down here to, you know, it's pretty serious, you folks. So I think we need an EPA check here of our air down there in the valley, making sure our air is okay to breathe. And I'm serious. These poor people, they deserve to get a break. And we all in the valley need to get a break in the valley. We're all being sucked in all that gas leak in the air. Thank you. Please get a study done so that we can check our air.
Okay, Ms. Pearman, followed by Mr. Previn.
Okay, it's good that you're, I fully agree with all that you said. That's a terrible thing that what they did with the gas leak and screwing people's lives. And I'm glad that you're going to give them a spot where they weren't there. That's full fund credits for customers displaced from their homes. That's good. But I don't understand is what our customers are only eligible for refund credits if they no longer place any of the collection containers out of service. So it seems to me that this is probably a way to try to find a lower way to not give the refunds to everybody that's been displaced by coming up with this term, but nobody knows what they're saying, but they'll end up being under that term so that you probably don't end up having to give anything. So basically, you don't want to make up for the mistakes that you made over there at the gas lake. I'm going to leave it down to a minute. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Previn.
Yeah, yes, it's Eric Previn from CD2, and I'll just take 60 seconds, sir. And I assume you're allowing, since this is a double meeting, double the time overall, since it's almost 100 items. This is, as described, sort of a waste tax for the people in the area who have had a trouble. We're going to try to credit back some of the tax, is the proposal by the commissioner from CD12. Well, these are folks who have had to be displaced, and it's my understanding that we are covering all of their waste needs where they are. So to credit them back money, though appealing, I'm sure, to the council member and to the recipients of any money, is hard to see, frankly. I don't quite get the benefit since we are providing, I assume, for all the relocation poopy charges that may go along with it. So this does seem like yet one too many things. So I would say, along with the crazy legal fighting, thank you.
Okay, let us prepare to vote on this item. Oh, I'm so sorry, Mr. Englander.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. Colleagues, I've been consulting with the Department of and Public Works and Sanitation, as well as the City Attorney's Office, who are all here if anybody's got any questions. And what this is would allow us, under all the rules, essentially to credit back those folks who have been relocated during the gas leak, particularly since both the governor proclaimed an emergency as well as the county health department issued a relocation order for those residents as well. And so there's already a system in place that we have, and they've been great in working with us. And I really want to thank the city attorney's office and the department for all their help. And we're going to work with all of the residents that have been relocated, up to approximately 6,000 now households that have actually been relocated, to make sure that they, while they were out, they don't have to come back and have bills that services that weren't provided, where we didn't send anybody to pick up their trash, or actually they drove right by their home because there were no cans out. On top of that, I just want to make a special announcement, Mr. President. This is pretty cool. So while we were doing all of this, it dawned on me that all these people had been moved out, and they're probably paying their cable bill also, and they're not home. So I picked up the phone, and I called Dean Leavenworth, who's here from Time Warner. And he picked up the phone, and fortunately, the folks in his corporate office, their cable wasn't disconnected. He got a hold of them, and they've agreed to work with all of the residents as well. A lot of residents actually that had moved out did shut off their cable temporarily, but many of them didn't. and didn't even think about it. And so Time Warner is more than willing to work with those folks on their billing issues as well and get all the ones that are coming back home and people really want to get home quickly to make sure that they get reactivated as well. So for those folks, they can call 888-TW-CABLE toll-free, and they will work with them directly, and we really appreciate the partnership on that as well. I urge you to vote yes on this. Thank you so much.
And Dean, thank you and your company. Let's prepare to vote. Let us open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Okay, we're going to go to item 31. Okay.
We have to vote on that. Please.
Okay, before we go to 31, why don't we vote on urgent forthwith on the last item? Mr. Clerk, you with me?
I'm with you, sir.
Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Okay, now we'll go to item 31. Ms. McAllister and Mr. Spindler. Item 31.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to tell everyone to go to the committee meetings also. That's where you really find out what's going on. Now, I was in a committee meeting. It was Wednesday, February 10th, and it was the Ad Hoc on Comprehensive Job Creation Plan Committee. Now, this is what happened. The department heads were supposed to report on where these city contracts, now we're talking about contracts, I know you know what I'm talking about. We're talking about money. And it was on the assessment on the percentage of the city contracts that are held by local small businesses and options to establish a goal participation in the request for the proposals. Now, the committee members, which included Mr. President, they asked these department heads to report on where this money was going, who was getting the contracts and stuff like that, what was the percentage, and do you know what they told them? One man in the department head, he said, he was from the mayor's office. He said the department, some of them refused to give that contract information. Refused. Now, that's what I was talking about when I said the gangsters. These people here, good people, I believe, but they're not running anything. And one of the committee members told the department head, he says, hey, well, the mayor wants this information. They said they don't care if the mayor wants it or not. You're not getting it. The contracts, that's what this is all about. There is a hidden government in this city. They control what's going on in there in these departments. They don't give a darn who we elect. They run it. Now, you go online. It's on the city's website, and the meeting is there. You can hear it. Now, it starts at 15 minutes. I don't know what they're doing to these online audios, but they're starting them 15 minutes. People think there's nothing there. Go 15 minutes in. It's Wednesday, February 10th at 1 p.m., and listen to the man tell them that they refuse to tell you who's getting these contracts. So they don't run anything. And the mayor don't even run anything. That's why he don't bring his little skinny Ren down here.
Mr. Spindler.
That's right. Fighting the poverty pimps. But we can't because there's secret information. Cutting off audio. And I'm glad to see one councilman has joined us on our side of the fight. Marchese now is sitting on my side of the fence. He's off the horseshoe, thank God.
Stay on the subject.
Staying with my brother. Now we see that we're fighting together to stop this corruption from these poverty pimps.
He is not talking about
we're going to stop this.
Stay on the subject, Mr. Spindler.
To know what happened to the audio tape. And why secret poverty pimps
thank
are stealing you.
You're
city
off
money.
Thank
they're
you.
Stealing
your
the city
expired.
Money. Fuck
okay,
you.
Sergeants, help him find his seats. All right. Let us. I'm sorry, Mr. Krikorian.
Just for the record, the item that the speakers were talking about has nothing to do with this item. That was another item being considered by the committee that same day. This matter involves Section 108 loans, and as members know, for over 40 years, the city has used federal funding to offer Section 108 loans to small businesses for major projects, for special projects, to create jobs and economic stimulus. Sometimes the federal bureaucracy takes as long as 4 months to get a loan like that authorized. So this, what's before you are new guidelines that the city's been working out with HUD to be able to get local approval rather than going through Washington, which should shorten that timeline from as long as 4 months to as short as 4 weeks. So this is an important step forward in trying to create funding opportunities for businesses that might not otherwise have access to capital at favorable rates to be able to create jobs and create economic activity in the city. So I ask for your aye vote.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk.
Yes, Mr. President, for clarification, amending motion 31A, that's motion Krikorian-Wesson, has been circulated and is now before council for its consideration.
Okay, let us open the roll. Close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
All right. Okay, we're going to now move to item 89. Item 89, we have some cards, public comment cards. I'd like to call Martha, Martha Arguello. Martha, come on down. Rabina Sin, Walker Foley. And Samuel, you'll be on deck.
And Mr. President, amending motion 89A has been circulated for this
Wonderful.
Matter.
Good to see you again.
Hello. Good morning. Thank you. My name is Marta Arguello. I'm the Executive Director of Physicians for Social Responsibility. We represent about 1,200 health professionals who are deeply concerned with the health and safety problems associated with urban oil and gas operations. We believe that urban oil and gas operations pose an unacceptable risk to all communities. This is a 19th century practice that has formed part of our urban fabric. They've become invisible. We don't see the derricks. We don't see the pump jacks. We don't see the drill sites. We don't see the underground pipes and storage tanks until there is an incident. We've grown accustomed to these, but we've grown accustomed to these because we've made a very dangerous assumption. We've assumed that somebody is minding the store. And we've assumed that mining the store means protecting the health and safety of residents, putting the health and safety of residents above the profits of the oil industry. Well, we've made a dangerous assumption, and today we're here to support the call for the hiring of an oil expert with one caveat. We think that in the 21st century, we should be hiring a health and safety expert to help wean ourselves off of fossil fuels. So again, we applaud this hire. We hope that health and safety is centered to the hire and centered to the expertise that this person holds. That way we can stop this dangerous practice that is putting many residents at risk. We've heard about Porter Ranch, but we forget that the risk of people in South LA face every day, and we've been able to ignore that risk, and it's time we stop. Thank you.
Thank you. So please come forward and identify yourself.
Yes. Hi. My name is Rabia Sen, and I'm with Esperanza Community Housing Corporation. We are here as Esperanza and also as part of Stand LA, Stand Together Against Neighborhood Drilling Los Angeles. And we work with low-income communities of color in South Central who for too long have been on the front lines of this issue and who are the most impacted by unsafe and unchecked industrial practices. Urban oil drilling is occurring in their backyards, across the street from their homes, their schools, their parks, and it has made their homes and neighborhoods inhabitable and caused severe acute and chronic health issues. Urban oil drilling has no place in our neighborhoods and is fundamentally incompatible with community public health and safety. This has been borne out, especially with all the focus that has been put on Porter Ranch. And to highlight what the previous speaker said, it has been happening for years and years in communities of South Central. What we are asking here is that with this motion, you use it to shift the city's focus to protecting community public health and safety, including looking at land use issues that govern the decisions that bring unsafe industrial practices into neighborhoods, as well as shifting the focus to holding industry, especially the oil and gas industry, accountable for their unsafe practices and putting so many of our residents in danger. Thank you.
Thank you. Sir, please come forward and identify yourself.
Yeah, my name is Walker Foley. I'm an organizer with Food and Water Watch, and we work with communities to stand up to corporations that put people before profits and advocate for a democracy that improves people's lives and protects our environment. We believe public health must be the foremost consideration when talking about this industry. And ultimately, we believe this industry has no place in a dense urban population and no place on a warming planet rapidly headed toward total ecological catastrophe. The historic actions of oil and gas companies in the Los Angeles area suggest that our communities and our health are not a valued part of their business model. So we thank you for continuing to work on urban drilling, neighborhood drilling. This should be a priority for the city of Los Angeles, but our concern with this motion is that it comes without public hearing, without regarding the voices of the communities most impacted by this industry, and therefore this decision. There's a single neighborhood council on the community impact statement that speaks to this motion, and we believe that if not handled properly, this position could easily give way to regulatory capture. We already know that the California Independent Petroleum Association is walking these halls and lobbying for who they would like to fill this role. So the original motion contains no guidelines for what kind of professional should fill this position, and more alarming to us, makes no mention of public health, only the responsibilities to be performed, which mostly pertain to industrial operations. And in fact, when you dig into the responsibilities that seem to have guided this position from its inception in the 50s, you see an emphasis on managing city leases with oil producers, making this a profitable thing for city revenue. The staff report on November 5th of 2014 indicates, and is one of the only documents I've found, that mentions public health in respect to the scope of the responsibilities to be performed, and it's not mentioned in this motion. So we support STAND, we support Esperanza and Physicians for Social Responsibility in asking that this position consider public health as a foremost consideration to the scope of the responsibilities for this role.
Thank you. Okay, now, Sam, we got the right item for you here.
Ha, glad to be back. Sam Sukaton with the Sierra Club, speaking for the 40,000 members we have in Los Angeles and Orange County in our Angeles chapter, also a CD10 and Koreatown resident. It's always hard to follow Walker, but, you know, same song, different key. We want to thank the council for drawing their attention to this issue. We know the petroleum administrator position hasn't been fulfilled in most of my lifetime. However, in that time... historically, the petroleum administrator's priority has been making sure that LA gets its money's worth from energy extraction. In those 25 years, we're realizing that environmental health, public health and safety are parts of that cost that we haven't paid yet. So I want to echo my friends at Esperanza, PSR, and Food and Water Watch by thanking the council for their work and encouraging them to adopt public health as a major guiding principle in this hiring process, as suggested by your planning department and by Councilmember Koretz's a friendly amendment. Thanks.
Mr. Walsh and Mr. Gus, I don't have a card on you, Mr. Spindler. I'll look for it if you've submitted it. Mr. Gus, you're there, so you can come right up.
1 minute only, please. 1 minute only. Daniel Gus, for information purposes only, follow me on Twitter at PovertyPimpHerb. So this is and that's my real Twitter handle, by the way. So I'm wondering, what neighborhoods are you going to be drilling in for oil? I have a feeling it's not going to be the wealthy CD5 and the wealthy CD11. I have a feeling it's going to be in CD8, where Mr. Harris Dawson is going to have to deal with this for however long he cares to stay on city council. But we have two jobs here, and I know Mr. Wesson is fond of giving his family these jobs.
You're off the subject. Stay on the subject.
Okay, I just want to make sure that they're not going to go to Wesson family members.
You're off the subject. Thank you. All right? Come
on,
Mr. Walsh.
No,
Mr. Walsh, come on. Floor is yours.
Thank you. John Walsh, blogging at HollywoodHighlands.org. A petroleum administrator. Whenever something goes out of total control, you build a bureaucracy around it. A petroleum Mr. Oil or Ms. Oil. And as the previous speaker said, they understand drill where people are not white. We don't need a petroleum administrator. The total cost of the petroleum administrator, because there'll be a deputy administrator, an assistant administrator, there's going to be an office. The total cost of the administrator, who has no power to do a damn thing except come up here and jerk off for your entertainment, is going to be $1.75 million a year. And next year it'll go up by 15 to 20%. HollywoodHighlands.org.
Okay, do we have a Monique? Monique, come forward. This is my last card. I don't have any other cards on this. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, good morning. My name is Monique Uriarte, M-O-N-I-C. I'm a member of TAN LA. And I want to say I really support the motion to get and hire a petroleum administrator, but I'm against Mr. Eglinder amendment because I'm a resident where I were victim of these health symptoms when gas is leak in our neighborhood. My whole community was experienced horrible health symptoms, and I asking to consider to hire a person with health experience in this issue. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I want to go to Mr. Koretz. That concludes public. I have no cards. That concludes public comment on this item. Please sit down. Mr. Koretz.
Thank you, Mr. President. I think it's no secret we have a broken oil and gas system in Los Angeles. The Porter Ranch gas leak, the other oil drilling problems we've had, especially those which occur right next to homes and schools, are part of a much larger systemic problem. Now, we've been waiting for a CLA-CAO report from Energy and Environment Committee on my original motion on the petroleum administrator since last August. It's ridiculous, and in the meantime...
Mr. Koretz, hold your time. Mr. Spindler, sit down. Ms. Cernoff, you have to move from the center island. From the center, please sit down. Thank you very much. Okay, sorry about that, Mr. Koretz. Continue. No, we're not going to put cuffs on you. Sit down, dear. Mr. Koretz, no, sergeants, help her find her. See, nobody's arresting you. Nobody. Just get out of the center aisle. Sit down. Sergeants, have a conversation with her. Mr. Koretz, go
Mr. President, I'd like to speak, but you have to have this woman that's yelling in the center aisle.
Let's go talk to her, Sergeant.
Have a seat.
She's continuing to disrupt. Just sit down, Mr. Okay, now Mr. Previn, sit down. Mr. Previn is disrupting the meeting. Okay, Mr. Koretz.
Thank you, Mr. President. And I want to thank you for your leadership in bringing forward this motion in place of my motion, which was stalled. When it comes to the health and well-being of communities who are on the front lines of drilling and deal with the most immediate impacts, we should be moving with greater haste. And I believe Councilmember Englander should be commended for working so hard and so quickly to protect his constituents in Porter Ranch. And I think we should accept that as a strong new precedent to work that hard going forward to protect the health of all Angelenos. And my request as we move this forward is that we engage with the communities that are impacted, those folks who have oil wells in their backyard, including many in CD5, to see that their needs are met and their health and well-being is not just protected but prioritized. No more nosebleeds, no more chronic respiratory problems. We need to get a handle on this. In addition to being qualified to carry out the job duties listed in the decades-old description of Chapter 4 of the LA Administrative Code, I want the petroleum administrator...
Yes, this is a disruption of the meeting.
Sergeants, show Ms. Cernoff the outer office. She's disrupting the meeting. And then take Mr. Spindler as well.
Anyway, I'd like to ask...
Mr. Spindler needs to be removed as well. No, Mr. Spindler needs to be removed as well and done now, for he's disrupted the meeting as well. Come on, we have a lot of work to do, sergeants. Clear. Ruth, you're disrupting. Ruth, we let you speak all the time. You're disrupting the meeting. Sergeants, help her to the back.
I don't know.
Ruth, you have to be removed. Ruth, you have to be removed.
Mr. Previn, and Previn, you go too. Sergeants, Mr. Previn as well. Mr. Previn, you're going to be removed right now. Please remove Mr. Previn right there. Sergeant, right now.
It's not a request.
No, it's not. Just you've got to go. Okay, we'll recess the meeting until these people are removed.
Mr. President.
Sergeant, wait, Mr. Englander. Sergeants, and get Mr. Previn, you are removed from this meeting. Mr. Previn, he's continuing, Mr. City Attorney, to disrupt this meeting. Okay, Mr. Sergeants, he won't move. Do what you have to do. Thank you, Mr. Previn. You have to leave and leave right now. Mr. Englander.
Just wanted to note from behind the pillar that he continued disrupting the meeting, and now he's just floating around the back and not adhering to or complying with the officer's request to leave the chambers, and continues to disrupt this meeting. And
well, he's leaving now. Mr. City Attorney, did you have something you needed to say? Mr. Koretz, to wrap up. Take your time. Collect your thoughts.
Time disrupted
restart.
As much as I had, but I really wanted to make one point that this shouldn't just be a petroleum expert. They should also have expertise in public health and safety and environmental protection, because we're not just looking for an industry hack from the petroleum industry. We need someone with a balanced background and point of view.
Let's move to Mr. Bonin.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you for calling on me, but thank you for this motion. This is an important action today that this body is taking for too long, really, at least a couple generations now. The position of our petroleum administrator has not been filled the way it should be. It has not been a vigorous or vibrant position dedicated full-time to managing these leases and conveyances and all the other stuff here in Los Angeles. I do want to point out, though, that Mr. Koretz spoke about what I feel to be is a different position, which is the oil and gas expert that the CLA's office is going to hire. That was a result of a motion that Mr. Koretz and I put in, which has a vitally different role, and is the role that folks from Food and Water Watch and the other organizations were talking about looking out for neighborhoods and looking out for transparency and accountability. That's the position that we need. Vitally, to make sure that we can complete the moratorium on fracking that this body committed to over a year ago. And that has been approved by the Energy and Environment Committee. Thank you, Mr. Fuentes. It's in the Plum Committee, and my understanding is that it's waiting for a report from the CAO and the CLA in order to get that hearing there. So I'd request, as part of this, that the CAO and the CLA expeditiously finish that so Plum can hear this item and we can hire the other position so that we can actually move in tandem on both of these items. But make no mistake, this is a big step that we are taking with this position today to make sure that we have a much better sense of vigilance. We cannot trust the state to look out for our interests, as we have seen. Dogger is not doing a sufficient job, and we can't have someone part-time here in Los Angeles. We need someone who's really an expert in keeping an eye on the oil and gas industry. And so I look forward to supporting this, and I look forward to supporting the other position, and hope it will come forward very quickly. Thank you, Mr. West.
Now, thank you. Mr. Buscaino.
Thank you, Mr. President. I, too, rise in support of putting together this, supporting this administrator. You know, this administrator is really going to impact my district. I have the most pipelines, heavy industrial surrounded by refinery, also on the port complex as well. And my first ask of this petroleum administrator is to do a review of the liquid bulk facilities in my district for potential safety issues. And we owe it to our residents in the city, specifically those living in my district in San Pedro and Wilmington and Harbor City, heavy industrial, and looking forward to continuing working with the fire department and the new petroleum administrator. I appreciate this moving forward and looking forward to working with them. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Kerkorian.
Thank you, Mr. President. Just as a friendly amendment, I'd like to ask that the CAO and the CLA be asked as part of this to review cost recovery and whether or not the costs associated with the petroleum administrator might be borne through the permitting and franchise fees and so on that the industry currently pays to the city or otherwise, so that there won't be an adverse impact on the general fund.
Thank you. Mr. Fuentes.
Thank you, Mr. President. And Mr. Bonin, thank you for following the process, because I think you recited exactly where we are in that particular motion, which is very important. I think an apology is due to the CLA's office. The insinuation that somehow any of this is stalled is incorrect. The CLA's office is working very diligently to try to figure out how it is that we satisfy the measures that are being put forward in this motion, as well as the one that was referenced by Mr. Bonin. So thank you, CLA, for all the good work that you're doing. Things take a little bit longer than folks want sometimes, but it's to no fault of theirs.
Okay, that no more speakers. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
That is approved. Mr. Rue, item, is it 94?
94, yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. President. Regarding 94, on February 4th, 2016, the Cultural Heritage Commission was unable to act on a historic cultural monument application for the Acker Mini Mansion located in Los Feliz. Unfortunately, all five members were not present at the meeting, resulting in a 2-2 vote, thereby effectively denying the application. The designation has a significant amount of community support, and there are legitimate concerns that the interested parties may not have did not have adequate time to present their views. So the action I'm requesting today is that this case be remanded to the full five-member board of the Cultural Heritage Commission for additional opportunity to consider the application and to give the community the opportunity to present to the full board. Again, for clarification, this action is not intended to deny the commission's decision, but simply send it back for the consideration of the full body. So that's what I'm doing today, and I'd like to ask the city clerk for some clarification, because on the motion.
Mr. Root, would you, Mr. Clerk?
Yes, sir.
Direct your...
In approving the recommendations proposed by Councilmember Root, we require two votes. First, to assert jurisdiction, and then second, to veto the action.
Okay, so let's have our first vote now. Let us open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Mr. Rue, now the second vote. Let us open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Okay, we're now going to take up items. Mr. Krikorian.
Thank you, Mr. President. On behalf of Mr. Wiesar, I'd like to ask that we reconsider item 1I. For purposes of requesting a 30-day extension of time.
Okay, so let's quickly vote on reconsideration. Where,
Mr. President.
So what, do we have to vote to suspend the rules? Okay,
yes.
Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Now we will vote on reconsideration. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
And that will be continued. How long?
30 days.
So that will be continued until March 18th. Thank you. Let's now move to items 73 and 74. I believe, Mr. Clerk, we can take those items up together. And if I could have from the Selmar Neighborhood Council, Ann Job, are you still here? Ann, come forward on both items.
And for item 74, there is an amending motion, 74A, that has been circulated.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
So am I speaking on 73 and 74?
Yes,
73
go right ahead.
Now?
Yes, we've combined those items.
Okay, and note that we do have a community impact statement on these two items. Okay. My name is Ann Job. I'm the president of the Sylmar Neighborhood Council, and I speak on behalf of the Sylmar Neighborhood Council and the community we serve. The NC has submitted a community impact statement in support of these council files, authored by our council member Fuentes and seconded by Englander. Further, we want to thank the Englander for moving expeditiously these items to this council so that they can be addressed prior to the mayor getting putting out his budget. Our hope is that this become a part of the upcoming budget. I want to thank our council member Fuentes for proactively providing Sylmar with the rapid response vehicle and for partnering with the neighborhood council to see that we get this extra item. I was going to speak about the fire station in the second item, but I will I'll fold it in here. I want to thank for the expedition of this of these two items again, saying that they will maybe will be a part of the next budget condition. We fully support the Public Safety Committee's position that Sylmar Station 91 be renovated. We fully support the Public Safety Committee's position that a new fire station be constructed that will provide Sylmar with a truck and ladder company, an engine company, and ambulance. The discussion has also indicated that the need is greatest above the 210. I'm here to say thank you on behalf of Sylmar to our council member Fuentes for his leadership and his partnering with us to get this much needed service, long-term service, as well as the short-term service. We thank you so very much.
All right, let's prepare to vote. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Okay, let's move on now to item 18, where we'll begin a hearing process on that item. Mr. City Attorney, on this item, I'm going to ask for 1 minute per card. We'll start off with, I think it's J.J. Burton and Cal Burton. I cannot make out the first name. Last name is Miller. Alberto Trevino, Benjamin Biamoff. So anyway, sir, identify your, let me defer to the city attorney.
And just for...
And then I'll recognize Mr. Fuentes.
Mr. President, this item deals with the protest that was noticed with respect to the rate case, and I will defer to the city attorney's office in a second, but just so that members of the public are aware, and for anybody who's watching, it may help inform their comments. It is anticipated that the rate cases will be heard in the Energy and Environment Committee beginning today. First, we will do the water case, and then subsequently, we will do the electricity case. And at some point, we will go ahead and give a committee opinion to the full city council. But for today's process, the item was agendized because it's a legal requirement as a result of Proposition 218. This council is not taking an action today on the rate cases. Mr. City Attorney, correct me if I'm wrong on any of that, but I wanted to make sure for all of those of you who attended or are attending today's meeting based on the anticipated rate case, it's coming, but it's not today.
Mr. City Attorney?
Just to follow up on what Mr. Fuentes said, as per the notice in the agenda, the hearing will be continued and the ordinance presented on March 1st in City Council.
Mr. Burton, pleasant surprise. Good to see you, sir.
Well, first of all, Mr. President, I want to bring greetings from all of our friends and congratulations on all of your success from being a Chief Deputy.
I'd love to hear it, Cal, but you got to stay on.
I understand. I'm going to use his minute also.
No, you got to be just use yours.
Okay.
I can't trade a minute. Things hold his time.
All right.
Things have changed since we were here back in the mid-'80s.
Okay.
So now go on, Mr. Burton.
You have just dated me.
Okay. Both of us.
First of all, I want to thank you for letting us speak today. And to my right is my nephew, J.J. Burton. We own the property on Crenshaw and Florence, the whole block. And we are at this point in the process of building 250 units for senior citizen housing, as well as a mixed use at the bottom, commercial. The corner of Crenshaw and Florence is very vital to our community. The rate increase would pose a severe hardship on the seniors who are moving into our complex, as well as all the business people. So we ask you, please, Councilman,
thank you, please. Thank you. So now, JJ, you want to wrap it up?
Yeah, just thank the councilman.
Yeah, thanks a lot, everybody.
Okay, so now we bring Mr. Miller, Mr. Trevino, Benjamin Benimoff, Judy White, Paul Gray. Please identify yourself.
My name is Linda Miller. I'm an engineer. I live in the city of Los Angeles. And I want to complain about the rate increase proposed by LADWP. As an engineer in the city of Los Angeles, I have considerable experience working with LADWP, and they are very incompetent. I worked for them one summer as a student engineer, and their main argument with me was to work slower because I was making everybody else look bad. Why is our water system that was built 80 to 100 years ago, why is it falling apart? Because we haven't maintained it. What has LADWP done in the last 80 to 100 years? They haven't been maintaining our system. Our lines continue to break, and instead of pumping the water and saving that and using that, they just let it run down the sewer.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So Alberto Trevino, Benjamin Benimoff, Judy White, Paul Gray, please come forward. Yes, identify yourself.
Yes, good day, council members. My name is Alberto Trevino, born and raised in L.A. I'm a business owner and property owner. I urge you, when you do comes the day to vote on it, to vote no. DWP wants to substantially raise rates. One, by creating new tiers and smaller allotments. Two, by massive new debt borrowing. And by three, revenue decoupling and driving up rates in consequence of conservation to maintain ever-growing target revenue, a blank check bridge to nowhere. According to the DWP mailer, the multifamily water rate from January to April of 2016 for Tier 1 will increase 19% and Tier 2, 45%. We can do better than this massive inflation and blank check bridge to nowhere. I propose getting out of the Stone Age and into the driverless car future today, and here's how. One, automated smart water meters gives consumers real-time control over usage, conservation, leaks, and waste. It empowers the DWP.
Thank you.
To reduce its carbon footprint.
Thank you, sir. So if I could have the next speakers, please come forward. Identify yourself.
Good morning, Ben Benyumoff. On behalf of Jeff Palmer, my client is a very prominent LA developer. Throughout this process, G.H. Palmer, or is the name collectively for my client, has been involved with the outreach programs as well as the LADWP hearing that was held on December 15th and has attempted to make its comments known in the record that proportionality is really what our client is concerned about with respect to the multi-dwelling residential rates. The fact that the rates are 100% variable, we believe that does not meet Prop 218's proportionality requirements. But with that said, throughout this process, we've continued to work with LADWP staff to resolve some of these issues and believe that that can be done still through this process. So we've submitted a letter for the record.
Thank you, sir.
I'd like you to review that. And if you have any questions,
I'll take it. So if I could have the next speaker should be Ms. White, followed by Paul Gray, which should be followed by a Dr. Devgan and a Manjan Devgan. Yes.
Yes, I am Judy White, and I'm here to represent all of the people that are in the same situation that I'm in We are senior citizens. My Social Security check is $877 a month, my personal one. Half of it, I want you to all understand that, half of it goes to the utilities. We have cut down, we've reduced our water. Still, you know, no matter what we do, it still is half of my check. And then last month, we got a double gas bill. It was doubled. So maybe the city needs to cut back and not take the $250 million and put that into the infrastructure. Maybe the DWP needs to cut back, but you're affecting people's lives. And $50 a month extra is affecting people's lives. So look at my face and take a good picture of it. When you decide to vote,
thank you.
Picture me.
Thank you. So is this Mr. Gray?
Yes, it is.
Followed by Dr. Dev Ghan. And then I have a Karmasita Masur. Followed by Mr. Walsh. Yes, sir.
All right. My name is Paul Gray. I own a 9-unit apartment in Council District 4. The DWP notice dated December 2015 says a rate increase is needed to, among other things, transform our water supply by encouraging conservation. But to my knowledge, none of this money is going towards subsidizing the cost of installing individual water meters for existing apartment buildings in the city. My units are not individually metered for water. My residents do not know how much water they're consuming because they do not pay for the water they use. They have no direct motivation to conserve water. The current cost is astronomical for property owners to install a water meter. DWP calculated for me recently a cost of $2,700 per water meter. If DWP were to suddenly provide me water at no cost, it would take me almost 19 years to pay off a meter. Including my sewer charges in the calculation, it would take 10 and a half years.
Thank you, sir. So if I could have Ms. Mansour, Masur, followed by Mr. Walsh. Then Patrice Sherman, I believe it is. Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon to all of you. My problem is this. The rate increase is affecting me. I own a small apartment complex. And because of your law that states the tenant can be evicted only if they stay straight consecutively for 30 days. But what they do is they stay 15 days, and then they leave for one day, come back, stay for 20 days, leave, stays for 28 days. How can you control that? They don't care about water usage. I pay for the water that's free for them and the sewer system that goes out. Now, I need your help because I have no control over the use of their water. It's just too much. That's all.
Thank you, ma'am. Mr. Walsh, followed by Patrice Sherman.
John Walsh, HollywoodHighlands.org, DWP, Department of Wimps and Poops. But I must say, at least DWP doesn't poison us like SoCal. They're a competitor. But the number one here, of course, no raise in water rate at all. But this hearing is in accordance with Proposition 218. So state law takes precedence over your rules as to who may speak here. So you have to listen to anybody who wants to be heard here under Proposition 218. If you do not want to do that and you want to violate state law and say, well, you didn't hand a card in time, fine. When we then launch a legal protest, it stops the entire process. You will not get the DWP increase if we claim that you're violating state law. HollywoodHighlands.org.
Thank you, Mr. Walsh. Patrick Sherman.
That's right.
All right. Patrick Sherman, Irma Contreras. Now, I don't have a card on you at all. Carol Brule. Well, then I'll get it from the sergeant. Sit down, Donna. Okay, so I'm looking for Irma Contreras. Carol, I think it's Brule, and Ashura Bohanan. And if I have a card from Donna, please get it to me. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Patrick Sherman. I own multifamily apartment buildings.
I currently have to pay for my tenants' water and sewage, and this constitutes the largest expenditure in my overhead expenses. I object to an increase because that would cause a financial hardship on me. But more importantly, I have no control whatsoever on the amount of water that my tenants use. They have no incentive to conserve water because they don't pay for it. So if there is to be a rent increase, is there a mechanism in place that we could add some kind of surcharge and pass the rent increase on to the tenants? Or better, can we put a sub-meter on and alter their leases so that we can charge them for water so that they will have an incentive to preserve water, because otherwise there is zero incentive?
Okay, so thank you. If I could have the next speaker. Identify yourself, please.
Carol Byerly.
Ah, I butchered that. Okay.
I'm here representing myself and, as she said, a lot of the seniors and disabled people. I've born here, lived here all my life. My parents built our home here in 59 on dirt and tumbleweeds, and the gold medallion program from DWP, which they nixed in 3 months. And we've done all the other things DWP has brought up that have failed. DWP has never done anything with the money for 55 years, 57 years, that we have paid them. And we pay high prices. I now make $800 a month on disability from thousands that I used to make. I cannot live on a $400 to several thousand dollar water and power bill. And that is already my whole yard dead. I live at Christmas lights. You're going to have, there are people now I know that are living out of ice boxes because they have no electricity. Kids next door don't even flush the toilet because they don't. This is.
Thank you.
A third world country. It's not what we should be.
Thank you. So is this Ms. Cheryl Bohannon? Please come forward.
Good afternoon. Right ahead. And thank you for your time. I'm a resident, and then we're property owners as well, and that is the main concern, is what incentives will be put in place for people who do reduce their water usage? And then what are you going to have in place for property owners whose tenants will have no regard for water? I'm in the process of an eviction now because of tenants who have no regard for other consideration of other people. So please, when you are making these restructuring increases, that you do take people's lives in respect to that and their income, because I do have seniors and there's other residents around me who are on fixed income, who depend on Social Security. So these increases will make a very big difference in their cost of living. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so I do have cards that were submitted after we began the public hearing. Generally, I don't take them. I will take them on this occasion. So Ms. Pearman, Peter Fogler, Marion Fogler, and you guys know better, prior to the conversation on the item, you have to submit your cards. Go ahead, Ms. Fogler.
Okay. The fact is that this is under Prop 218. And you know what that means. It has to be placed before the voters for any increases that you have incurred from taking from the DWP and transferring it to your general fund. We have to have a voice here in stopping this charade once and for all. It's out of control, and your spending is out of control and needs to stop here now. Thank you.
Okay. Donna, you want to come up next, Ms. Pearman?
First, I'd like to thank you. I have an eyesight problem. I had trouble figuring out the agenda and didn't realize it was there. So thank you very much for letting me speak. Anyway, I'd like to say that we need to have a cap on the DWP so that we can't just go up. Like, persons' bill shouldn't have to double. That's ridiculous. People have to, it should be that we always have a large amount enough being paid for rent. We can't have now another large amount being paid for the DWP. I mean, it seems like people over there in the government, they're, the federal government, like the politicians, are able to get anything they want, and they can't give us a decent DWP rate. So let's put a cap on it and not go above that. And if we will have to have somebody to help us, we will.
Thank you. Elected. Mr. Peter Fogler, please come forward.
My name is Peter Fogler. I'm also a city employee. I'm basically against the rate increase, but I'm also doing my part to install solar power on my roof to try to mitigate this and help out. Thank you.
Thank you for coming down. That ends today's public comment. And there will be no action to taken today. Mr. Fuentes?
The folks who testified, this case will be bifurcated. The water issue will be heard today at 3 o'clock in the Energy and Environment Committee. The electricity case will be heard at some point in the future. There'll be a recommendation at a committee, and at some point in the future, it'll come before the full City Council for consideration.
Okay, and we're going to be continuing this to March 5th, is my understanding. First, my bad. Okay, let's now reconsideration on 89. So let's vote on reconsideration. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote. Mr. Bonin, for purpose of an amendment.
Yes, just want to make a quick technical amendment that I thought had been made prior to our vote, which is to, in the friendly amendment that Mr. Englander proposed, they added language requiring experience in the petroleum oil gas field. I wanted to make that experience or credentials in.
All right. So without objection, that'll be the order. Let's open the roll. Close the roll. Tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Okay, we're going to go to item 32.
And, Mr. President, motion 32A has been circulated.
Okay, I have cards. Carol Centrone, Brian Harris, Heather Fox, please come forward. Please come forward, identify yourself.
Sorry. Good morning. My name is Carol Citroni. I'm here in support of the historic designation for the Edinburgh property. How often in the history of Los Angeles has a nomination for historic designation been initiated by the head of city planning? I heard it has only happened twice. Not sure of the first time, but the only other instance has been for the Edinburgh Courtyard apartments. After Michael LeGrand's nomination, this application was fully inspected, vetted by the Cultural Heritage Commission, the Office of Historic Resources, the LA Conservancy, and with a mention by Survey LA as the cherry on top. We have been working tirelessly since September to designate this very unique property. Please confirm this now at this meeting. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. So if I could add the next speaker, identify yourself.
Hi, yes, I'm Brian Harris. I'm a property owner adjacent to this property. I live in a 1923 building as well, and I'm directly impacted, and I bought my property because of buildings such as the Edinburgh Bungalow Court. With all of the accolades and all of the people in support, including LA Conservancy, I would like to see this go ahead and pass as the next historical monument. Thank you so much.
My name is Heather Fox. I am a community advocate behind Saving 750 Edinburgh and have been walking the neighborhood for the last several months tirelessly. The majority of the community is very excited about this HCM, and we want to thank Councilmember Koretz for his consideration and all of you as well. Thank you.
Okay, let's prepare to vote on this item. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
And Mr. President, for clarification, again, that's as amended by motion 32A.
Okay, 86. I think we have Mr. Gus or Dan on item 86. Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so 1 minute only, please. 1 minute only. 86. You know, you're always telling us, you know, talk only about the things that are within the jurisdiction of the city of Los Angeles. Well, this is a perfect example of something that's not in the jurisdiction of the city of Los Angeles. But when you do it, you have to give us more leeway. So now you're talking about the Ferguson, Missouri grand jury decision. And what this is going to be the LA plan so that the next time there's a riot in another city where a young, unarmed African-American man is killed by police, of course, this is going to be LA's plan to control Los Angeles blacks, to control Los Angeles's, to intimidate them, to arrest them, and to beat them. If you're going to have a riot in Los Angeles, don't burn down CD8, please. Go to the wealthier districts if you want to be heard. And this item today is basically LA's plan to beat the crap out of unarmed black men. 1 minute.
Okay. Is Mr. Walsh still have time? Mr. Walsh, I think I have a card on you as well. Item 86.
John Walsh, blogging at HollywoodHighlands.org. This is a double meeting. Okay, Ferguson grand jury, you name it, racist Ferguson grand jury decision, emergency operation sent to activation against blacks and Hispanics, after action report, corrective action plan. I'm reading right off this what it says here. And I just want you to know that they're getting set up. Next time, you're not going to be able, Black Lives Matter, to get on that freeway, because they're going to blow your black asses off.
Stay on the subject.
The subject is the Ferguson grand jury decision. What the hell is this plan? It is a plan to, and you can correct me if I'm wrong. You have all the time after I finish. It's a plan to make sure that blacks and Hispanics, another killing,
don't do what they did this time. All right, let's prepare to vote. Let's open the roll. Close the roll, tabulate the vote.
13 ayes, no.
That brings us to item 90. Mr. Gus, item 90.
And Mr. President, a substitute motion has been circulated for this matter.
Okay.
90, that's the sidewalk one. Oh, Jesus, finally, we're doing something you're supposed to be doing for us. Congratulations. I want to know why there's three people on this, though. Why do you need three people as the maker of this motion? But this is exactly what you should be doing for the people of Los Angeles. Put in sidewalks. Keep us safe. Reduce traffic. Cut down crime. Do a better job with the shelters. But this is exactly what you should be doing. Why isn't this item number one every day? Better sidewalks. Better quality of life. For God's sakes, this is your job here. Not the other things. I'm going to stay on subject. This is what you should be doing, not the Olympics. This is what you should be doing, not the NFL.
Thank you, Mr. Gus. You're off subject, but thank you.
I'm giving you a compliment.
All right, let's vote on this issue. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Okay, so the first vote was on
whether to substitute,
and the second vote is on the matter.
Yes, sir.
So let's have our second vote. Let's open the roll, close the roll, tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Okay, now where does that lead us or leave us, Mr. Clerk.
Mr. President, that brings counsel to general public comment or special number one.
Okay, let's get Ms. McAllister, Mr. Dan Gus, Kevin Motis, I think it is, Bobby Pepe. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's very sad that we're going to have homeowners have their water fees increased. What that means is the people's rents will most likely go up, then they'll be put on the street, and then maybe these homeowners will be losing their apartments and their homes. I want to tell Americans, hold on to your weapons. Do not give up your guns. This leads us into communism. It's a slow process of taking over the property. That's what communism is about. The government or the crooks take the properties, and then they take your guns. Hold on to your weapons. Don't give them up. If you give up your weapons, we can forget it, because they're coming in on us like you wouldn't believe it. And they're using people like this, the people we elect, that they fund to get in office. They're using them to take us down. If you surrender your weapons, you're dead. And I say it like this. Before you surrender your weapons, go down shooting.
Okay, Mr. Gus, followed by Kevin Motis, followed by Bobby Pepe, followed by Rola Masri. Yes, sir.
Okay, so follow me on Twitter at PovertyPimpHerb. Because even if Herb blocks me, his followers still get to see what I write. So Herb just blocked himself out. So again, on Twitter, I'm at PovertyPimpHerb. So it's fortuitous that Ms. Barnett is sitting in the back of the room. Perhaps Mr. Barnett can tell us, Ms. Barnett can tell us why Mr. Wesson has more dogs than is allowed to have in a single residence in the city of Los Angeles. There's his Christmas card, Charlie, Cricket, Waldo, and Penny. By the way, thank you for sending this to me. You're not allowed to have four, Mr. Wesson. You need to get your ass in compliance with the city. Furthermore, Mr. Wesson, you didn't pay your damn dog license fees for 3 years. You didn't pay until 2014 for your 2013, 2012, and 2011 licenses. So what's going on? As city council president, don't you make enough money to pay the same fees that the rest of us do and the same limits that your girlfriend Brenda, by the way, not enough late
fees.
Thank
you. Thank you. So do we have Kevin? Is Kevin here? Bobby Pepe? Rola Masri, Jose Martinez, Sean Murphy. Yes, sir.
Good morning, Mr. President, council members. Glad to see you all here today. Oh, good afternoon now. My name is Bobby Pepe, a homeowner in Silver Lake and CD13. The city agency that monitors and cares for our urban forest canopy actually facilitates the destruction of our trees by corporations like Outfront Media through the permitting process. With that in mind, consider the harm done by Outfront Media USA to our neighborhood in Silver Lake. During the quiet week after Christmas Day, to clear the sight line for Outfront Media USA's billboard above the building at 3701 Sunset Boulevard, 9 trees were vandalized, 3 to the point of death, by Outfront Media USA. Outfront Media USA's general manager admitted to this at a recent community meeting. According to a supervisor from your urban forestry division, these trees' replacement cost is $10,000 or more. No permits were pulled for the topping of these trees. Do the math. This is act of vandalism is a felony.
Thank you. Thank you. No. Have to give everybody the same. So if I could have, is there no Rola Masri? Sean, are you here? Sean Murphy? Mr. Walsh.
Good morning, Mr. President. I got a new phone number. I haven't given it to some of your constituents. The one you got, Mr. President, is no more, okay? Mr. Ruse got it and Kerkorian's got it. Ask them for the new phone number. We need to keep the sidewalks clean. We need to keep our streets clean. That's it.
Mr. Walsh?
John Walsh blogging at HollywoodHighlands.org or Jay Walsh Confidential tweeting at Hollywood Dems. Okay, I would like to thank the apology that we received from Mr. Englender. He took total responsibility for the meeting being canceled yesterday. It cost several thousand dollars in problems. Now, this man wants to run and is running and was involved in campaigning that day for his the county supervisors board. This will follow him forever. If you put him on the county supervisors board, he'll have as terrible attendance record as he is has now. This is not what I'm saying. This is not my attack. He has publicly apologized for causing, and there hasn't been a drop of a meeting lost in several years.
Thank you, Mr. Walsh. Next speaker is Jose Martinez. Mr. Martinez, are you here? I see no one by that name. Next speaker is Mr. Hunt.
The Red Chief Hunt. You guys are in total violation of the Brown Act. Mr. Herb Wesson is running the meeting absolutely wrong. This is what you guys got a summary judgment about. Dow versus the city. Just because you guys only gave him a dollar don't mean you guys don't have to follow the law. And when city public does not follow the law, you guys do not set a good example. This is why the city attorney should be dismissed from this meeting, because he judicates over what needs to be said and who get kicks out, but he doesn't judicate that. If you are running the meeting wrong and you just got sued and you still don't follow directions of the federal judge, then you have absolutely fucked up the city of Los Angeles. And you guys totally do that absolutely wrong. This is why I want to debate Herb Wesson in the Ralph M. Brown Act anytime, any day, and on any radio station. The Red Chief Hunt.
Thank you, Mr. Hunt. Next speaker, Donna Pierman. Followed by Marion Fogel and Oscar Mohammed.
Anyway, you want to learn anything? Listen to me. I'm great, real great. Anyway, works for Mr. Trump. Anyway, reopen Van Nuys City, reopen Van Nuys video conferencing. It's terrible having to come here, terrible having to go through all that traffic, having to switch my days off, almost miss the item I want to speak in through this large, confusing agenda. Thank you, Mr. Wesson, for letting me speak on the rate hike. But still, you don't care about the public. It's banned to throw Wayne Spindler, Ruth Chernoff. Please, you should have let her speak. And Eric Previn, they weren't that disruptive. As you don't care about the city, the public, neither does Hillary and our Obama, I won't call him my president, and Kerry. They don't care about us, and they should be tried for war crimes, and they should be brought into the Hague, and if they need to, they should hang them if that's what the case says. Thank you.
Thank you, Donna. Next speaker is Marion Fogel. Oh, Mr. Koretz.
Madam President, I just wanted to ask if we could have item 21 go forthwith.
Sure. Item 21 forthwith for Mr. Koretz. Miriam, followed yes. by Oscar Mohammed. Go ahead.
Yeah, we've had a big loss losing the gentleman on the Supreme Court. And we are in trouble because we need a balance in this country. Freedom of speech here, it needs to be kept balanced, because the leftists, Hillary, Sanders, the Democratic Party is pounding very heavily on the Republicans for everything they can get. And let me tell you something. We got to stand up and not let this thing get out of hand and allow Hillary and Obama to destroy our country, because that's exactly what they're doing, and Sanders too. So we got to bring in someone here that's conservative, knows what they're doing, bring back the budget, get our budget back together, and help our military, and bring people, create jobs by bringing people back. Thank you.
Thank you, Miriam. The next speaker is Oscar Mohammed, followed by Jacqueline Richardson and Peter Fogel.
Yes, corruption in government has destroyed America. America is a poverty country. Capitalism and greed brings about bigger government, and bigger government brings about bigger taxes, more tax, higher taxes. We should end homeless downtown Skid Row. No African-American should live in that very negative lifestyle we see every day. We need more accountability. We have the Los Angeles law enforcement shoot unarmed black men in the back, shoot unarmed black men in the back of the head without any accountability. We need better leadership in Los Angeles. We should have responsibility. Freedom without responsibility is no freedom. But we look at history before us, we put people solve a situation what did, as what came before us. But we look at religion today. Religion seems to be in the back burner. But I know about we studied religion of Moses. Moses, he prayed on Mount Sinai to change. Jesus, he brought the gospel. He prayed on Mount Olive to change. And Muhammad, he brought the Quran. He prayed on Mount Light to change. And the answer was successful.
Thank you, Mr. Muhammad. Next speaker is Jacqueline Richardson, followed by Peter Fogel.
How will it affect the people of Los Angeles if the top brass in the Army, Navy, Marine Corps, and Air Force are Russian people? The top brass, how will it affect the people in Los Angeles? Next subject, 6th Street Bridge. What's wrong with the 6th Street Bridge? Will it break within the next 5 minutes? Can it be repaired? I don't really know. Can it be repaired without closure? It will affect the rush hour downtown Los Angeles. There's quite a bit of sexual harassment in the armed forces in the early 2000s. One candidate went down and tried to stop it. I'm wondering if the sexual harassment in the armed forces is still ongoing. If it is, it causes a hostile situation. It causes hostility.
Next speaker is Mr. Fogel. Peter Fogel. He needs to be here, Donna. Thank you very much. Peter Fogel is not in the room. Next speaker is Weena Elahari. Is she here? Weena? There's that person's not here. Scott Payne? Scott Payne? There's no one here by that name. Crystal Johnson? Crystal Johnson? Maurice Cole? Ma'am, are you Maurice Cole? Can you please sit down? Maurice Cole's not here. Diana Hobbs, it's not here. Leonard Arnold. Renee Pittman, are you here? Not here. Last speaker is Guillermo Villalobos.
What's her name?
Guillermo Villalobos. Okay, that concludes cards for public comment. Mr. Clerk, what's next?
Madam President, that brings us to special one. I believe the city attorney is going to speak to the findings.
Mr. City Attorney, go ahead.
Thank you, Madam President. I will recite the facts as presented to me by the maker of the motion for the council's consideration of the adequacy of the findings. Since the posting of today's agenda, staff from the state legislature informed city staff that the city's previous resolution in support of legislation increasing public disclosure requirements for oil and gas facilities is now reflected in SB 30, that the Assembly Utilities and Commerce Committee is taking up SB 30 on Monday, and that the city's previous position in support of the issue would not be reflected in the bill's list of supporters because the bill number had not been available when the city previously passed that resolution. Thus, there is an immediate need to act to adopt this resolution supporting SB 30 before the Assembly Committee hearing on Monday. Council must first make findings pursuant to Government Code Section 54954.2 before considering the substantive motion.
Mr. Englander?
Great. Thank you, Madam President. Colleagues, we actually...
Hold on for just a second.
Yeah.
We need to vote on the findings, Mr. Englander.
Vote on the findings?
First.
We're going to vote on the findings first. Let's open the roll, close the roll, and tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Okay, that passes. Now, Mr. Englander.
Great. Thank you very much. I was going to speak to the findings, so I don't have to now, but thank you. So with that, colleagues, actually on January 29th, we voted Council File Number 15002S117, wherein it was supporting this very piece of legislation. Having said that, the maker of this piece of legislation, Senator Fran Pavley, has called me directly asking if we can update this resolution so it can be part of the legislative file and package now that they actually have a different bill number, SB 380. The mayor has actually already written a letter on our behalf to the committee, but our resolution is not part of the package because they have it was under a different bill number. So with that, I'd ask for your aye vote. This is going to be heard on Monday. I will be there in Sacramento testifying as well under Utilities and Commerce, and ask for your aye vote.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Englander. Mr. Koretz?
Yeah, I was wondering if we could have item 20 go forthwith as well.
Sure. Item 20 forthwith for Mr. Koretz. I'm going to call cards on special one, Mr. Walsh. Followed by Miriam Fogler and Donna Pierman.
John Walsh, J. Walsh Confidential. See what they're doing here? This is a special agenda item they just put on a half an hour ago. It's not in the agenda package. There's no package. There's no information that you out there can find out about this issue. And this is a special agenda item, except through them. They sneak things through with the special one, special two. I was here when at the SoCal when you put that on a special agenda item and did nothing about it till 2 weeks later when the media hit it. The sneaky special items, they constantly do this, and this is part of, you know, in most countries, they put a bullet through the head of me, someone like me. HollywoodHighlands.org, no more specials.
Thank you, Mr. Walsh. Next speaker is Marion Fogel, followed by Donna Pierman.
I can't believe you people are violating the Brown Act by doing specials. And to me, this is unconstitutional, so it should be shouldn't be done. It's unless we have an earthquake. Thank you.
Thank you, Miriam. Donna? Ms. Pierman?
I just want to tell you it's bad for what you did to bring up and coming up with specials. I just saw John Walsh do that, and I thoroughly and completely agree with him that you shouldn't have a special item all of a sudden where people can't see it on the agenda before. It's bad enough that your agenda was vague and confusing, and it was hard for me to figure out which one was held and not held. So you just wanted to make it hard for the public, and now this special. Get rid of specials. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Pierman. That concludes cards on special one. Mr. Clerk? Let's open the roll, close the roll, and tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Mr. Englander?
Yes, and can we please vote to send it urgent forthwith?
Let's send it urgent forthwith.
We've got to vote on. We'd have to actually vote on that.
Okay. Open the roll, close the roll, and tabulate the vote.
14 ayes.
Thank you, Mr. Englander.
Yes.
Mr. Clerk was before us.
Madam President, Council has motions for posting and referral.
Posted and referred.
Madam President, before we get to that, Madam President?
Yes, I'm sorry, Mr. Blumenfield.
No problem. Can I ask that we, was that heard today? Reconsider item 43U, it's a lien item, a constituent's come forward, would like to reconsider it and then continue it for 2 weeks.
Okay, so.
It was continued to March 2nd earlier.
It was.
Correct. Okay. That item has been continued
to
March 2nd.
So this item was taken care of already.
43U?
43U.
It was continued for 2 weeks, Mr. Clerk?
Till March 2nd.
March 2nd.
Thank you.
Okay. No, you're welcome. So posted and referred?
The desk is clear.
Members, any announcements? Mr. Buscaino, did you have an announcement?
Adjourning.
Okay, so let's all rise, please, for adjourning motions. And looking to my left, Mr. Buscaino.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam President. Colleagues, I ask that we rise in honor, adjourn in memory of Marie Ungaro. She was born on August 3rd in St. Louis. With her family, she moved to San Pedro and married Henry Ungaro, one of the owners of the California's largest fish markets and restaurants, the San Pedro Fish Market. Together, they raised their family in San Pedro. She passed away peacefully on February 9th. She loved spending time with her family and friends and loved to travel just about anywhere. She was funny, boisterous, generous, and fearless. She is survived by her mother, Jenny, brother Matthew, or four children, 10 grandchildren, and preceded in death by her loving husband, Henry. In lieu of flowers, please donate to Marie Ungaro's name to San Pedro Peninsula Cancer Guild. May she rest in peace. And, as you know, the Associate Justice of Supreme Court, Antonin Scalia, passed away this weekend. Ask that we adjourn in his memory. Born in Trenton, New Jersey on March 11, 1936, to a Sicilian immigrant, Salvatore Eugene Scalia. His mother was also a product of Italian immigrants. He grew up in Queens, New York, where he earned a scholarship to attend Xavier High School, where he graduated first in his class, and then summa cum laude from Georgetown and magna cum laude from Harvard Law School. In his professional life, he held many prestigious positions, such as Assistant Attorney General for the Office of Legal Counsel, professor at the University of Chicago Law School, University of Virginia Law School, and was appointed to the U.S. Court of Appeals, D.C. Circuit, where he served with then-Judge Ruth Ginsburg, with whom he shared a close relationship with. Appointed to the highest court in 1986 by President Reagan and confirmed that same year by 98-0 vote in the U.S. Senate, making him the first Italian-American Supreme Court justice. He is survived by his wife, their 9 children, and their many grandchildren. May he rest in peace. Thank you, colleagues.
Thank you, Mr. Buscaino. Anyone else on my left? Seeing none on my right. Any adjourning motions, members? Mr. Koretz.
Thank you, Madam President. I'd like to adjourn in memory of one of the great builders and shapers of Los Angeles and elsewhere. On February 26th, we lost John Tishman, who passed away at the age of 90. He had a special influence here in Los Angeles, where his firm, Tishman Realty and Construction Company, transformed our city's skyline, including in my 5th district, where his twin towers have loomed large in Century City on what once was the 20th Century Fox backlot. Other major works here include Macy's Plaza Complex, the Ronald Reagan Federal Building, downtown's 48-story Wells Fargo Building, and many office towers on the Wilshire Corridor from Mid-Wilshire to Westwood. Across the country, the Tishman name and endeavors were hugely significant, running the gamut of famous efforts, including Walt Disney's Epcot Center in Florida, Madison Square Garden in New York City, a performance space at Carnegie Hall in Manhattan, the John Hancock Center in Chicago, and the Renaissance Center in Detroit. His most profound contribution may also be the saddest, for he was responsible for the World Trade Center, and on September 11, 2001, he watched TV coverage helplessly as his towers collapsed due to the terrorist attacks. He was much acclaimed professionally, civically involved, and in 2011, he wrote a book published by the University of Michigan Press entitled Building Tall, My Life and the Invention of Construction Management. His wife, Suzanne Weisberg, passed away in 2005, and they are survived by 2 children, Daniel Tishman and Catherine Blacklock, and 3 grandsons. And may he rest in peace and be remembered for his huge impact on Los Angeles and beyond.
Thank you, Mr. Koretz. Any other adjourning motions? Seeing none, this concludes our meeting. Our meeting is adjourned. Thank you.